Morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night, wherever you may be in the world, whatever time it may be. Hello, this is another live stream on a Friday, live from New York City, from the School for Poetic Computation. My name is Dan, and I'm gonna be here for a couple hours doing a few coding challenges, talking about Git and GitHub. My glasses are very dirty, so I'm going to clean them. So let me set the stage here for a couple things. Number one is the majority of you, if you, you know, some of you are watching this live right now, but you might also just be watching this as an archived video on YouTube. There will be a lot of things that happen. There'll probably be a lot of dead space in this particular longer video. You can go to this video's description, see various time codes where certain things happen, and also I will be taking various chunks out of this session and editing them into separate videos. So with all of that said, let me just make sure things are working technically. I see myself on a preview over here. I'm looking in the chat. Please, if you're watching this live and looking at the live chat, please let me know if you can hear me okay, if the audio's clipping or any interference, or just write that in the chat. Audio great, audio good, audio not good. Also let me know about the picture quality. Something that will be important as well is over here. I'm gonna write something on the whiteboard here. Let me know how that looks. Say whiteboard okay. And once I know that everything is working okay, I'm just gonna dive right in. Not too much exposition. Maybe I have a few things I wanna talk about in terms of scheduling and logistics, but I'm seeing in the chat that people are saying things are working fine. Okay, so I'm really enjoying this. I didn't have a lot of time this week to do more. This is the first session this week. Next week, I hope to do one or two sessions. The week after that, which is the week of May like 8th or 9th, I'm gonna be away in visiting the great city of Shanghai. I'm gonna see if I can figure out a way to do a live broadcast from there. It probably won't be this elaborate setup. It would maybe just be from a camera, you know, the webcam on my laptop, essentially, maybe with a screen grab, but because I really would like to do something live every week. When I get back, it'll be the May 15th is when I return, and I have no travel from May 15th all the way through around July 4th. So that's when I'm really kind of gonna dig in and hope to do two full sessions per week. I've started spending a little money in terms of making some visual assets that I might use. I've hired somebody to help edit the videos, make thumbnails, keep things organized. I really would like to get everything closed captioned, perhaps even do translations. So I'm thinking of starting a Patreon, which I will do probably when I get back from Shanghai, to see if I can raise a little funds to put a little money into, you know, just making this channel better and figuring out, like, what am I doing here exactly? Is this useful? Is this helpful? What are ways to make this better? So if you have thoughts and ideas about that or advice, please feel free to share that with me. I would love to hear your thoughts about that. I've also, you know, maybe I'll create, you know, a Slack channel for Patreon subscribers. Maybe if I raise enough money, I'll remove the YouTube ads, which aren't really generating very much income right now. Anyway, so these are things that I'm thinking about. Just wanted to put that out there for any advice or thoughts on that. Okay, so I'm looking at the chat again. Let me just see if, hold on a second. I've got to do a couple things on my computer here just to make this easier for me to look at. I see I've got 22 people on YouTube, and I'm gonna refresh. I'm also streaming on Twitch, so if you're watching this on Twitch, mostly I'm looking at the YouTube chat, which is YouTube.com/Shiffman/live, but you can also, but I am streaming this on Twitch because people are finding it that way, and maybe that will help gain viewers. Okay, so here's what I wanna do today. I want to do two coding challenges. I wanna continue the solar system thing I made last time. Oh, and I want to do that in 3D in processing, and you know, maybe we would sort of see how well the code translates to P5.js. I want to do maze generation, how to have a computer automatically generate a maze. There are lots of algorithms for doing that, and it's kind of a fun algorithm, and I thought, oh, that'll be like a 10-minute video, but I think that's more likely a kind of larger project. And then I want to continue my tutorial series on Git and GitHub. I've made 4 videos about that so far. If I open up my to-do list here, I think the last thing I talked about were GitHub issues, so I think I might actually be in the phase of that video tutorial series to talk about working locally on your laptop, downloading your repository from GitHub, working on your laptop, pushing it back up to GitHub. So that'll be something, working with Terminal, that'll be something that I will try to get to today, in the next couple hours. I am checking the chat again. I see there's some comments coming in. And I guess I should also announce, just if people aren't aware, that I have an online course coming out on Cadenza. Let me see if I Google this here, if it comes up. It might ask me to log in. Let's see if it asks me. Oh, good. Okay, so this is a course. There is a company called Cadenza. They are a online education company in the vein of Coursera or other companies like that. However, they are 100% dedicated to art, visual art, creative coding, technology, and art. And they have a lot of great courses that I watch a lot of the videos for. One of them that I'm really interested in, and I've been trying to keep up with it, is Rebecca Fiebrink's, I don't know if I pronounce her name correctly, but Machine Learning for Artists course, really excellent. Anyway, so I have a Nature of Code course. For those of you who have been asking for JavaScript versions of my Nature of Code, Physics Simulation, Motion General Algorithm videos, I made those videos for this course. So currently, as soon as this is open, you'll be able to watch those videos for free through their website. It'd be interesting to think about if there's a way I could kind of also put those videos on my YouTube channel. But again, those videos are owned by this company, and they were really, I really enjoyed working with them. So I'm excited to see how that works. And you'll be able to, if you sign up, you can submit assignments and that sort of thing. Okay. I also, of course, would be glad to take any general questions about processing, the Processing Foundation, P5JS. Another thing I want to do today is use the Atom editor instead of Sublime, just to try like a different editor, see how that goes when working with JavaScript. And that's that. I'm going to check the chat right now to see if I have any comments. People are just saying nice things in the chat, which is enjoyable to me. Which is nice, enjoyable, what's the word? Okay, so I don't want to waste too much time. I'm streaming, I'm recording, I'm making sure that my audio is good. Let me just check the mic batteries. I've got 3 bars, and I've got 3 bars. So I'm finally getting better at this, like making sure the mic batteries are good and all that. I'm just cycling the cameras. Okay, so I think what I want to do first, let me get myself set up here, is start with the solar system challenge. I'm going to close this. I'm a little sniffly today. Can you hear that? I might need to go grab some tissues. I have a pack in my jacket because I'm a person in a room with a jacket and a backpack. There's an outside world there, but yet I'm in a room by myself talking to a camera and you are watching. And there are 21 people. My goal one of these days is 100 people watching live. We'll see if we can. I don't know if this is a good time for people. Okay, so what was I saying? Okay, so what I want to do is open up. I've lost track of things. I want to open up, Coding a Rainbow. Oh, where are all the interesting? Where did I put these? Rainbow? No, that was something else. Examples? Interesting. You know where all this is. Okay, sorry, apologies everyone. This is me not being ready. I'm going to go to, I need to go to, sorry everyone, I know where to go, I'm just trying to figure out how to get there. One moment, please, bear with me. I need the, like, one of these days I'm going to get, like, the Jeopardy theme music, and I have my soundboard, and I just play that, and would kind of have some music would be in the background while I'm doing something that's very much dead air. And what I want to do is I need a shortcut to, I'm logged in a different account, but on this account, I have a lot of the code that I've been working with. So I want to just grab it from over here. There's a bunch of things I want to grab. And I'm going to grab that, grab these. I hit copy. I want to go to Coding Rainbow on my desktop here. And make a shortcut to that, and paste these things in here. Okay, that should be good. And now I also want to get rid of some things that I don't need, because it's confusing. Just setting up my desktop here. So there's less stuff here. And what are, and then also I'm going to just put a lot of stuff that I'm not working with currently in the desktop, the documents folder. Okay. And now I have just these things. And I'm going to clean up my desktop. This is what I mean to do all this stuff before I get started. But sometimes I don't get to it. Okay, let me move this up here. Clean up desktop. Okay, so now I'm getting closer to being ready. I'm going to check the chat, see if there's any questions. Phone timer. Ah, thank you, Adam. Neo Geo Box TD underscore 2 folder. Where'd you guys see that? You guys are looking through my folders. I would love to show that project, although it's a project that I sort of kept meaning to get back to and I haven't had time to. It's a collaboration with a wonderful artist. Mandelbrot set as a challenge. That's a great idea. Let me add that to my list. Someone suggested Mandelbrot set. Phone timer. So I'm going to use my phone as a stopwatch to kind of keep track of how long I'm going in each video. That's great. And I'm going to now open up processing, the solar system generator, which was 2D. Excuse me, I'm going to get a tissue. I muted my mic while I was blowing my nose. I'm also going to step out of the camera for a second. My mic is not muted while I continue to remove. Okay, so somebody on the internet really complained. You know, it wasn't so unreasonable. I have one of my videos, which is a long archive, just has like 15 minutes of me like drinking some water and looking for something. You know, I'm trying to, I would like this to be more like a class and, you know, in an actual classroom, I wouldn't spend 15 minutes looking for something, but there would be some kind of just random space. All right, 28 people are here. We've been going for 12 minutes and I think I am ready. So I have too much to get to today, but I want to try to do all of this. Solar system into 3D with textured planets. We're going to talk about the cross product in 3D vectors. I found some stuff that I couldn't figure out before in the last week. I mucked around with, so I have a better sense of it today, I hope. Maze generation, which I think will be a very basic algorithm, which teaches a lot of different concepts just by implementing it. And then I think if people take the example code, we'll be able to make a lot of creative applications of it. And that sort of thing. So I want to... I want to review for myself before I begin with the sort of like more official tutorial part, just where I was last time. So this is what I had, and I'm going to do solar system generator. I'm going to take this, turn it into 3D. I'm going to add textures for the spheres, which I think will be a nice thing to do. And then I'm also going to show you the library PZCam in processing, which would allow me to have like some quick and easy camera work, which I think will be good. And one improvement, the first thing I want to do in this, so I think I might do this in like three parts. So by the way, I have a new idea. So I have just straight tutorials, which are like the Git and GitHub tutorials, or the beginner JavaScript tutorials, or HTML and CSS tutorials. Those are like long tutorial series. I started this idea of 10-minute coding challenges, like short videos to implement a little project, and some of them actually worked, like circle packing, and there were a few other things. It wasn't really circle packing, but there were a few things, Starfield. There were a few things that actually fit into that like 10 or 15-minute video. And then there are other things more like this, which is like to make a solar system simulation. I started in 2D and then moved to 3D, then add textures, then add PZCam. This is really a new series that I'm going to start calling, I think, Anatomy of a Project. So I'll have a project with an actual sort of creative goal and build it over 3 or 4 or 5 videos. So I'm still experimenting with different formats. I haven't really figured this out. But so I think the maze generation, honestly, like I want that to be like one short video. It's complicated enough that it probably merits multiple parts. But anyway, I'm still sort of tinkering around. Right now, I'm just kind of making videos and doing stuff. But this solar system thing right now, I'm going to think of it as an anatomy of a project. There was a half an hour video that made a 2D one. I'm going to make one video that turns this into 3D. I'm going to make one video that adds textures and one video that adds PZCam. And maybe those will be in the same video because those are kind of short little things. I always say things are short and then they're not. Someone asks, Andrew Kim asks, maze generator is going to be awesome. Thank you. Are these algorithms for solving mazes as well? So that would be interesting to do. In a way, like the algorithm I'm going to show you that generates the maze basically generates it by solving it backwards. Which sounds weird, but so in a sense, it is going to have that aspect to it. But what I'm really focusing on is just making the maze pattern, which you could then make a PDF from, print it out, all sorts of exciting possibilities. Okay, so what I want to do here is in this example, I'm just looking at the font size and getting myself kind of like situated here. I also want to add a few improvements, and I think before I transfer to 3D. So I think I will, this is just going to be part two of my solar system generation. And I'm going to add a few improvements to this. And then I'm going to turn it into 3D. And then part three will be adding textures and PZCam. OK. Yeah. And by the way, A9Cat fan. How do you pronounce that? Neon Cat, Nine Cat? Boy, that's embarrassing. Okay. Right. A simple algorithm to create the maze is DFS, which you can use to solve it too, but it's very inefficient. And yes, the algorithm I'm going to show you is very inefficient, but it's fun to watch it work. Okay. All right. So I am going to, I've got 33 people here, 4 people on Twitch. And depth first search. I think that's what I'm going to be using. I'll show it to you on Wikipedia. I read the Wikipedia page this morning, figured it out, and made a quick example, and I'm going to recreate it live. All right, so I'm going to hit this timer. I'm going to take a deep breath, and I'm going to start part two of the solar system generator. Let me just recycle these cameras real quick. I will need the whiteboard to talk about vectors and the cross product. here we go. So if you have important questions that you want to ask, so you guys, those of you watching in the live chat, while I'm doing this, talk amongst yourselves. That's great. If you have important questions you want to ask me, you probably want to save those for when I finish this part, because I won't look at the chat for about 10 or 15 minutes while I'm doing this particular tutorial. However, if something goes wrong, like the audio cuts out or the camera cuts out, and you're trying to get my attention, direct messaging me or something on Twitter. Maybe my phone will buzz. Okay, here we go. And now, I don't have to hit record anymore. I just have to hit this. And all right. Welcome to part two of some multi-part series about making a solar system simulation generator in processing. And what I'm going to do in this particular part is take the 2D simulation I made last time and turn it into 3D. And then I'll make a couple more videos that do some other things to it as well. But step one will be 2D to 3D. Okay, so a couple things. One thing I want to do actually before I go to 3D is make a couple small improvements on this. Notice here that some of the planets which are orbiting, there's all sorts of things that are wildly unrealistic about this, so don't get me wrong here. I'm not trying to make anything realistic that's really, simulating how Kepler's laws work and that sort of thing, although I'd love to get to that at some point. But what I don't like is that certain planets that are moons that are orbiting other ones are kind of overlapping in a weird sort of way. And I think something that I can improve here is that notice how each planet gets a radius and then it gets a distance, which is how far, radius being its size and distance being how far it is from its thing that it's orbiting. And so these are being set in the constructor. And I think what I can do here to make things a little bit better is actually when I make a new planet, right, its radius is going to shrink. That's what I did last time. And then I don't know why I've like I kind of want to just like start over this. I don't know why I'm doing this because I should just be free, but I want to start over because I lost my train of thought and I kind of like was rambling and I want to just like dive right in. So apologies, those of you in the chat watching this live, but you know, more people are joining. I've got 38, trying to get up to 100. I'm going to start over for a second because I also like just sort of forgot what I was doing and I want to look at this because the planets, I need to remind myself, the planets get generated with a radius and a distance, and that distance could be a random value between the current radius and the current radius and the new planet's radius. Got it. Okay, I got it. Sorry, everybody. I'm going to start this over. Follow my heart. Yes. Okay. Here we go. Apologies for repeating some of my lines, but I'm going to do it anyway. A sip of water here. Okay. Oh, let's have this up here. And now I'm going to stop this, reset, and go. Welcome to part two of my solar system simulation generator thingamabob. So this has turned into a multi-part series. I'm probably going to do one or two more, but this part, what I'm going to do is take this 2D solar system orbiting thing and turn it into 3D. So instead of circles, we're going to have spheres. Instead of rotating just around in a two-dimensional plane, we're going to rotate in a three-dimensional space. So now, before I get to that, I want to make a couple small improvements here. I think I could be a little bit more thoughtful about how I pick the sizes of the planets and how I pick how far they are from the thing they're orbiting. So let me dive into the code real quick before I make this a 3D version and just go down to where that happens. That happens here. Every time I make a new planet, it gets a radius that's based on the previous one. They're shrinking. And it also gets a distance from the previous one, which is some random number. And this is what I could really improve. So one thing that I want to do is say, okay, the distance, if I wanted it to be perfect, So if I have this planet and I have this thing orbiting it, if they were exactly touching each other, then their distance would be the two radii, the sum of the two radii. So first thing I could do is just show you that, and I'm going to change this to radius plus r. So let me run this now. We should do you see how the first one worked? I don't know what happened with the second one. Let's think about this. What did I miss here? The distance, I'm dividing by level. So I should actually just say that. And now you can see that they're in a sort of precise location. Every single circle is rotating around the edge of the other one. That's kind of a nice effect. I almost want to keep it this way. And by the way, you get some really interesting patterns if you drew like trails where the circles are going. You try that on your own. Send it to me. But I'm not going to go down that road. But what I'll do is I'll just say, why not make distance be random between that exact spot and that distance and that amount times 2. So in other words, I'm saying, let's make a random distance between where this would be exactly and then this exact amount times 2, so over here. So the planets will orbit somewhere between being exactly touching the original planet, the orbiting the thing, and a little further away. Okay, so here we go. So now we can see, I don't know, I just kind of like how this looks better. Everything has kind of a more thoughtful spacing, and I don't know if the ratio of the sizes is good, but we'll get worry about that stuff later. Because what I really want to focus on is moving to 3D. Okay, exciting. Now is the time. 3 minutes into this video, we're going to add 3D. So the first thing I'm going to do to add 3D, this is going to be a magical thing, is I'm just going to go here, and I'm going to say 600,600,P3D. Dun-dun-dun-dun! 3D solar system, there you go. So this is actually now rendering in 3D using Processing's 3D renderer, but of course I'm still just drawing circles and I'm still just placing everything along that two-dimensional plane. But it is important to note that Processing, one of the reasons I like to use Processing is that it lets you sort of blend and blur the lines between 2D and 3D. It gives all the 2D drawing stuff in 3D. But let's look a little more carefully at this and start going making this even more 3D. So first thing I could do to make this more 3D is instead of drawing an ellipse, I could draw a sphere. So the function to draw a sphere in processing is just the word sphere. And then sphere takes a diameter or radius? I'm not really sure. Let's try radius. So in an ellipse, notice how I said radius times 2, because I know for a fact the radius, the ellipse function requires a full diameter as the argument, but I think sphere maybe just wants a, does this look right to you? And now, first of all, like, it's sort of hard to see what's going on. So first of all, you see what a sphere actually is. Everything in 3D is made up of all of these kind of like polygons and shapes, and you can see it's just this mesh of all these kind of rectangles with a line divided, but it's really like a triangle mesh. But we don't want to see all that. What we want to just see, and so one thing that I'll do is here in where I'm drawing it, I want to say no stroke, and I'm going to just say fill 255, and I'm going to do this again. And now look at that. This, nothing about this looks 3D, because I'm just staring straight at these spheres that are pure white, without a texture, without some shadowing and lighting. I don't really even see that 3D effect. So the one thing I could do just to kind of see the 3D effect is just add the very generic function lights. So lighting in 3D is an interesting and complex topic, and you can have spotlights and directional lights and ambient lights and different colored lights and all sorts of things. I'm gonna stay away from that. Maybe someday I'll have the courage to do a video about that. But lights, the simple lights function just generically adds kind of a wash of light into the scene, and you'll see what that's gonna do. So now we can see that now this has the appearance, they have the appearance more of spheres. It's very subtle, but there's some shadowing on the spheres based on the lights. Now, this is almost like, hey, we're done. I made this simulation in 3D. Look, and in a way it looks kind of 3D, and I could add some camera work and do some other things, but everything is actually happening all on one plane. And what I want to do, and this, I'm gonna try to draw a diagram here just to kind of like work this out in my head, is let's say I have a sphere. What I want to do is arbitrarily, now again, I'm not doing anything that has anything to do necessarily with how the actual universe works. I'm just trying to create something that looks kind of interesting and figure out how stuff works in processing. But I want to arbitrarily create a vector out from a particular planet and create another planet and then maybe rotate around the planet. So there would be, all of this would happen, I'm drawing in two-dimensional space, so it's very hard to do and I have no artistic talent whatsoever, so I can't even really draw this well. But you can sort of imagine, I want to arbitrarily place a planet out here and have it rotate like this, or one out here and have it rotate like this. So the idea is that I want to make a vector, a random vector. So let's do that. And I'm going to go into the planet object. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a variable. I'm going to call it v, just for lack of anything else that I can think of right now. I'm going to say v equals pvector.random3d. So this here is a particular, oh boy, I'm not in the right place. Sorry, everybody. That was a little awkward moment there, but I don't know. Maybe some like CGI magic can fix that someday. But so what I created here is a random 3D vector. So any vector pointing in space that is of length 1. And so then what I want to do is multiply that vector by distance. So in other words, I want to scale it by the distance that it should be. So again, if only I had like good spherical things here. My fist will be a planet. Then I make a unit vector of length 1 pointing out, and then I want to scale it by some distance that it should be, and now I have another planet out here. Visual aid, boy, this is quite pathetic. I need props. Somebody send me some props. Okay, so then when I'm drawing it, let's look down here. I don't want to translate simply along the x-axis by some distance like I did in 2D. I want to translate by that vector, v.x, v.y, v.z. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to take out rotation for right now and just translate, and we can see what's going on here. And you can see that there are a bunch of spheres. And let me fix a few things. Oh, you know what? I'm going to keep going. So let me fix a few things to make this sort of easier to figure out. Number one is, if you recall, the planets are picking a random number of moons. So I want to just change that to one. So every planet just has one moon, and I'm also going to have fewer levels. So we can see now that when I run this, what happened here? Okay, wait, pause, time out. I'm thinking about this for a second because this would be so, I really should add PZ Cam at the beginning because all this stuff that I'm doing, it would be so much easier to see it if I could just kind of move the camera around. So I'm thinking about whether I want to do that or not. And also I ran into a little like issue here just now, which why am I seeing, because I made 5 for the original one. There we go. So in other words, this would be much easier to follow if I could now move the camera around. Should I go back and restart it? Should I just add it here? PZ Cam is such an easy thing to add. So I almost like, it barely takes any time. I can just fit it into this video and do it right now. All right, I'm gonna continue from where I was. The problem was just that I forgot that I did 5 in the original one. Let me check the chat. Switch cameras, yeah. Okay. All right, so, yeah, I'm gonna add PZ Cam in this particular video because why not? It's so easy to add it. Okay, because it's gonna make things easier to look at. It's worth it, it's totally worth it. Okay, so I am about to continue from where I left off. And I'll just continue. Oops, so I forgot that in the original sun, the original planet has 5 moons around it. So I just want to have that start with 1 also. And we can see now that we have something simpler to look at, which is just 1 sun in the middle, 1 moon around that, and 1 moon around that. Okay, I'm realizing something. I'm realizing that this would be a lot easier to look at and understand if I could just really quickly like drag the mouse around and like spin the planets and turn the camera. So even though I intended to do this in a separate video, right in this video right now I'm gonna add something called PZ Cam to this example. Okay, so how do you add PZ Cam? PZ Cam is a library and I'm gonna do sketch, import library, add library. Oh, PZ Cam is already added. So so I've already done that. I don't know when I did that. But by the way, what you'll need to do is here, go to add library, search for PZ Cam, click this, and then you'll be able to click install so that it's installed. And then you shouldn't need to restart processing, but if you run into any issues, just restart processing. Okay, so once you have PZ Cam installed, I can do sketch import library and just select here PZ Cam. And you can see it added some import statements to the top. A library being something that allows you to bring in additional code that's not part of core processing to call automatic functions. And what PZ Cam does is it automatically adds interactive mouse camera work to your 3D thing. So then all I need to do is create a PZ Cam, or maybe it's just a PZ object. No, PZ Cam object? No. What is it called? Oh, PZ Cam? There we go. PZ Cam object called Cam. And I'm going to say Cam equals new PZ Cam. And I think I have to say this to refer to this sketch because it's going to control this sketch's 3D view. And then I give it like some number, which is basically I want the camera automatically to look at the center of the world, 000, from 100 units away. So by the way, if I wanted to look at a different part of the world, I could say I want to look at 0, 100, 0. I could add that in as well. But I'm just going to say this, 100, and I'm going to run it. And now you should see, now where is everything? Oh, it's all weird. So why am I not able to like find the stuff and kind of rotate around it in a way that makes sense? The reason is because I had this extra translate in there, width divided by 2, height divided by 2, so that was my kind of like camera work to just like move the origin to the center of the window. Now that I'm using PZ Cam, I don't need this anymore. I can run this and we can see, oh my goodness, look at that. There it is. I'm just like 100 pixels away. And I think if I hit like Command, I can pan or Control, I can zoom in and out. But this is what I want to see. I want to see something like this really easily. And so what I'm going to do is just start 500 units away, start further away. So now we can see this is what I've got. And you can see now the shadowing. You can see there's two, each one of these has a, this planet has one moon and that planet has one moon. Let's even remove this and just start now with a single moon. So we can see here I have the sun and a single moon. How can I get that moon to rotate around the sun? Okay. Here's how we're going to do it. Now, I'm sure there's some really excellent 3D, thoughtful, smart, fancy way of doing it. I'm going to do it in a sort of tricky way that I know works, that I hope works. And I'm going to use something called the cross product. Okay. So let me come over here and let's talk about the cross product. The cross product is, let's say I have two vectors. Here's a vector, here's another vector. The cross product of two vectors is this, a vector that is perpendicular to both of those vectors. So if these were my vectors, I would still also get this particular vector. So the reason why I want to do that is, remember, this is the sun, this is the vector where my moon is, and what I want essentially is for that vector to rotate around the sun like this. So what I need essentially is a vector that's perpendicular. Like I want it to rotate around this axis, like this. So in other words, let me try to do this in three-dimensional space. I don't know, props. I have some tissues. They'll be my planets, right? Here's the sun. I'm going to go. I'm a vector. The moon comes out, and then I have my fist is the sun. I have this perpendicular vector. I want to rotate. I've totally lost myself. I think if you would just imagine it or sort of think about what I'm doing, it makes sense, right? Because I need, like, I can't rotate. If I rotate around this axis, this is just going to spin, right? This is the vector. If I rotate around that axis, it's just going to spin like this. I want that whole vector to rotate, so I need a perpendicular vector to rotate around. If this makes any sense to anybody, then I'll be surprised and very pleased. Okay, should practice explaining that. But so how do I get a perpendicular vector? So right here, what I want to do is make another vector. I'm going to call it P for perpendicular. I'm going to make a P vector V. And what I want to say V dot cross. So to get a perpendicular vector, I want to take the cross product with something. Well, what should I take the cross product with? Honestly, I could be smart about how I'm doing this, but if I just pick some arbitrary, I mean, there's a lot of, in three-dimensional space, there's a lot of vectors that are perpendicular to this vector. This one's perpendicular, this one's perpendicular, this one's perpendicular, this one's perpendicular, right? Any of these vectors are perpendicular. So I just want to get an arbitrary one. So if I have some other vector, I'll get something, and I do the cross product, I'll get a perpendicular one. So what I'll do is just say V2 equals new P vector. And I'm going to just arbitrarily pick a vector that points straight out. And you know what, maybe I'll actually just pick something sort of arbitrary. And I'm going to make P the cross product of V, the vector that is actually coming out from this planet to where, out from the sun to where this planet should be. And now I've got some perpendicular vector. And now I can use something here. I can use processing's rotate function. In 3D, you can say an arbitrary axis I want to rotate around. So if this is the x-axis, rotating around the x-axis would be like this. If this is the y-axis, rotating around the y-axis would be like this. Z, rotating around the z-axis would be like this. So the functions rotate x rotates around this axis. Rotate y rotates around this axis. Rotate z rotates around this axis. But if you want to rotate around this axis, you just need to give it the vector and then the angle. And what's the vector I want? The one that's perpendicular to the planet sticking out. So I'm going to say rotate p dot x, p dot y, p dot z. So rotate around the vector from the x, y, and z by an angle. And let's run this now and hope we get something that looks right. Am I not increasing the angle? I don't think, oh no, the angle is increasing. What did I miss? Time out, everybody. Let me look. Let's look. Is angle first? There we go. Okay, so the angle was the first argument. So look at this. Now I have this planet perfectly orbiting this other one. So lovely. Now, let me just, to be clear, let me draw these two vectors so you can see what's going on, because I think this will make things make a little bit more sense. So let me draw a line from 0, 0, 0, vx, vy, vz. Let me draw that. And do I guess I need to give it a stroke here. And I should say no stroke down here. And let me just get the stuff where it should be going. Can you see it? It's very hard to see it in there because it's not the planet's not very far out. So let me draw it longer so you can see it. I'm gonna multiply that vector by 10. There, you can see that is the vector that is controlling where that planet is. Now let's draw the other one, the perpendicular one. This is the axis around which I'm rotating. And now you can see that's the axis around which it's rotating. It's a vector that's perpendicular to that one. So this is just a quick and dirty way to get a sphere arbitrarily rotating around another sphere at some arbitrary axis that's random. So again, you might have some other algorithm by which you want to calculate this stuff. And I, you know, the cross product that I picked is just some arbitrary vector. I probably could be more thoughtful about that, but this works, okay? So now we can start doing a couple things. One is, let's make sure this is really working by adding, where do we pick, let's add another level. And you can see now, in addition, this one now has, this other smaller one is rotating around that one, and you see all of the perpendicular vectors. Maybe what I'll do right now is get rid of this times 10 thing, and you might still be able to hopefully see everything kind of. You can see these vectors here. And maybe let's get rid of, I'm like lost in my own, this has like become fascinating to me, and I like forgot that I'm recording a video talking to anybody, and I'm like, oh, let me try this. But you know, it's useful, I think, to see the lines drawing the vectors, but the point of this really is to do what? Is to not have these lines, and to just see these planets arbitrarily orbiting each other. So now you can see, here we go, and I can zoom in and out to kind of get a closer look. And now I'm going to do the exciting moment. How long have I been recording this? Maybe like 20 minutes or so. I'm going to do the exciting moment where the whole point of doing this was to allow each planet to have like a bunch of things. So like, for example, what if I give it the first sun to have two moons orbiting it? You can see now we've got something a little more interesting here. And you can see the rotations are could be weird enough that you could start to like, it almost looks, the speeds could be very slow. The way one is rotating around another while the other one is rotating could make it kind of have this optical illusion of not rotating. But I can assure you that if we that everything is rotating around everything else. And then I can also, let's give it four to start with, and then let's also allow them when they create their moons to do what? To have a random number between zero, let's not give them too many, and two. So we can see now, look what we've got here. We've got a nice system of many planets orbiting other planets. Everything's spaced out, and everything's at random angles along random axes. So hopefully this gives you the idea of how to get started with creating a three-dimensional sort of nested solar system where you have a sphere with spheres rotating around it, with other spheres rotating around it, and with other spheres rotating around it. And this code, you can find, if you look in the description of this video, you'll find the code for this. And what I'm going to do in part three is I'm going to add textures to these planets. So I'm going to show you how you can draw the spheres with other textures and maybe put a background or something else like that to make it feel more spacey. Okay, thanks for watching. Okay, so that is the end of this, that part. One of my lights, by the way, it just like goes on and off like randomly, like the cable is loose, and I thought I fixed it and it's still doing that. It's very distracting. So how is that, everybody? Any feedback, any thoughts? And I got some people on Twitch watching, I got some people on YouTube watching, and so I'm gonna take a minute now to download some textures and where I'm gonna get them from. So there's actually an example in processing itself, which is, where is this example? Contributed example, no, where am I looking? Demos, graphics, planets. So this is an example that Andres Calubri made, I believe, that's in the processing examples, similar to what I have, but just sort of like some fixed, you know, it, what it's doing nice, ooh, we should add this. It actually has a light coming from the middle. That would be a great thing to add. So there's like a light that's, the sun is actually creating a light. Let me see how he does that. Excuse me, shape, sun. I swear there's a light. Oh yeah, point light, which is at 0, 0, -150. So we can add a point light there. So I'll do that also. But what I want to look, oh, that's cool. And he's making like some Perlin noise textures. That's kind of interesting. What I want to do, I meant to have that open because what I want is this URL. So I need to have something that doesn't have copyright, which I assume Sun and Mercury textures from Planet Pixel Emporium. Let's go to this URL. What does it say here? I guess this is already in the video. Or maybe you may download, some require PayPal, this is a measure, but okay, so I sometimes receive copyright information. You'll find a statement about copyright on the main planets page. I'm looking here on the site, are copyright. They are free to download and use as source material in any kind of project, personal. You are not free to redistribute them. You are not free to redistribute as in any medium. Okay. And not the results of the maps. The results of using the maps are free to use and distribute, but the maps as direct source. Okay. Let's see, I have permission. They may not be included as they exist on this site in any kind of commercial. Okay, I think I'm okay to use these images in this video, and I can always ask for permission as well. So the question is, where do I get them from? Where do I download them? Home, and the camera went off. I could also just make my own, which would be actually, that's a great subject for a tutorial, how to make a spherical texture. So where do I download them from? Planets, you'd think it'd be under planets. Download. Okay, small library. Drawing tutorials. Planets. Planet texture maps. Example one. Maybe I go to specific, like sun. Ah, I see. So here we go. Got it. So let me just download that. Okay. And then Mercury. Let's download that. And let me grab. Can you guys see something flickering? Because it's that light that's flickering on and off. It's making me crazy. I should just turn it off, I guess. Mars. That's kind of cool. Let's download this one. He has high resolution ones that I guess you can. So that's good enough for right now. Oh, I want to get the Earth one if there's one. Sorry. Earth. So that'll be a nice one to have, color map. Okay, so now I have these, and I'm going to take these and put them in, whoops, not here. I'm gonna put them into sketch here, and I'm gonna go to the, that's fine, shoot. It's fine. Into the data folder. And put them in there. And I'm going to do save as 3D texture. Okay, so now I'm ready. And maybe I'll reference this example as well very briefly. And then this website. And that'll be that. Okay, so I think I am ready. Okay, let me check the, can we make them elliptical orbits as well? Ah, that's a great question. Let's think about that. How would you make it an elliptical,
Well, the distance would, you'd have to change the distance while it's rotating. So it would go, based on the angle, you could do a mapping of based on that angle, it's either far away or closer. And that would be interesting to try. maybe I'll add that in a part four or something, but I've got a lot of things to do today, so I'm not sure if I'm going to do that part, but somebody do that as an exercise.
Okay, so I am going to get ready for the next part. That's good too. People are discussing other solutions and possibilities. I'm just going to turn that light off because it's driving me crazy that it keeps flickering. I mean, I want to have more light in this room because it makes stuff look better, but it's not going to be that light. It's just not going to distract me anymore. I can't believe I tried to use tissues as props. That was kind of a little bit of a disaster, I think, but life will go on. Okay, so in this video, I'm going to demonstrate, I'm going to open up this example. I'm going to demonstrate how to add textures to the planets, which we need P-shape for, as well as adding a point light, which is like a light that's emanating from the center, from the sun. Okay? So let's do that. Yes, here we go. Okay, and I'm not gonna look at the chat now for about 5 or 10 minutes or however long this takes. I'm going to set my timer going and talk about this particular example that is part of processing. Then move back to my example, show the Texture Planet website, and which I will link to from the video, and then add the textures to the planets. Okay, great. Okay, here we go. Part three. I think I'm on part three now. Hello and welcome to. Hello and welcome to. Okay, part three of my solar system generating simulation thingamabob. This, by the way, is not my example. This is an example by Andres Calubri. It comes with processing under examples, demos, graphics, planets. You can take a look at it. It's using some similar stuff that I'm using in my example, but the reason why I'm pointing to right now is you'll notice that the planets that you're seeing are not just plain old spheres that are white or one single color. They have a texture to it, a texture that is an image. So what I want to show you now is how to add image textures to a sphere, just like in this example, in the one that I've been building. So the first thing is we need some image textures. Boy, I would love to make a video. Somebody remind me someday of how to generate your own texture using Perl and Noise. And you could procedurally generate textures for all your planets. That's going to be a part something to this eventually. But for now, what I'm going to do is get some image textures. So Andres, in the example here, you can see that he has a link to a site called Planet Pixel Emporium. This is what the site looks like. For example, down here, I can click on Earth, and I can go down here, and I can get this particular texture. It's just a rectangular image. And what's going to happen in processing is this image is going to be taken and wrapped around that sphere. So how do you do that? So I've already downloaded a bunch. I'm going to close this, and I'm back. This is my example. If you don't recall, this is what it looks like. What I'm going to do is now add the textures to these spheres. So I've already downloaded a bunch of JPEG files, PNGs would work, various file formats, and I've got them in the data folder. So I'm just going to look at those real quick, and I'm going to actually just rename these. Earth. I should have done this before I started Mars, Mercury, and Sun. And all of these come from that particular website, Pixel Emporium, Planet Pixel Emporium. I will have a link to it in this video's description. OK, so what I'm going to do now is I am going to say p image equal, and then in setup, I'm going to say load image sun.jpg. So the first thing I need to do is just have that image loaded into a variable of type pimage, loaded into that. And now I need this image to somehow be attached to that sphere. Let's go to where we're drawing the sphere. Now, I am drawing the sphere right here. This is known as immediate mode rendering, I think. Yes. Save mode, immediate mode. The point is, I'm like drawing the sphere. So it's like calculating and figuring out and making the sphere on the fly. There is something in processing called a P-shape, which is an object that can store geometry about any type of shape. So it can have, you can make a P-shape that's a geometry of a collection of shapes, that's a custom polygon, that's a sphere, that's a rectangle. So what I need to do to automatically texture this sphere is to use a P-shape variable, which will make it a little bit easier to deal with. So I'm going to go back up here and say, P-shape, I'm going to add to every planet object is going to have a P-shape associated with it. And I'm going to call that P-shape globe, because it's going to be a sphere. And then in setup, I'm going to say, not in setup, sorry, in the planet's constructor, I'm going to say globe equals create shape. So create shape is the generic function to make a P-shape object. You can make group P-shapes. You can make primitive P-shapes, which is like rectangle, ellipse, sphere, box. Or you can make custom P-shapes, which are just set out of a lot of vertices. And boy, this would be another great topic for a video. But for right now, I'm going to make a primitive P-shape, which is just a sphere. And I also need to give it some size. Guess what? I have the size right there, radius. Now, the other thing I want to do, this is going to seem a little bit strange, is right here, I'm going to say no stroke and no fill. Because when I call create shape, it's going to pick up the stroke and fill that are kind of currently assigned. Now, there's all sorts of other ways. I think you can call set stroke or set fill, and then you can change those later as the program is running. But for right now, I just want a sphere with no stroke. And you know what, actually? What I want, just to make sure this is working, is set the fill to 255. So I just want to have my shape be white. I'm not going to add the texture just yet. And now the other thing I'm going to change now that I've made that P-shape object is here, instead of drawing the shape, drawing the sphere with sort of immediate rendering, I'm going to render that pre-calculated saved geometry, that sphere that was already made. So I'm going to say now, shape globe. So the shape function renders a particular P-shape object to the scene. That P-shape object being globe. So if I run this, we have exactly the same thing. And just to make sure this is really doing what I think it's doing, let me do that.
I'm afraid.
Ah, yes, and now they're all red. So you can see how this is working. Now, the thing is, I actually don't want to fill. I want to say no fill. And this is what is so wonderful about working with P-shapes and spheres and textures is processing behind the scenes will automatically figure out how to do all of the mapping of the image and the pixels to the poly. There's all sorts of interesting custom ways of doing this. But I can actually just say globe set texture img and run this. And magically, you can see all these planets now have that one sun texture. I can zoom in and you can see it's that same texture on all of them. So we're kind of, even I didn't hit my timer, so I don't know how long I've been going. But just a few minutes, 5 minutes at the most into this video, I already have textures on these planets. So what do I want to do next? Well, I only want to have the sun texture on the center one, and then I want to have other textures on the others. So let's figure out how to do that. What I think might make sense is to, I'm going to make a variable called sun texture to load that. And then I'm going to make another variable, which I will make an array. Well, I'll just call textures. And how many do I have? I have one, two, I just have three. So let's have three. And then I'm going to say textures index 0 equals, and now apologies for the tedium of this, Mars, Earth. I'm going to load these just sort of manually into the array, manually setting the index spots. Mars, Earth, Mercury. So now, where should the planet get assigned its texture? I just kind of globally assigned it one, but I think what would make sense is for the planet to have a particular, actually, I don't need a variable. What I just need here is to add a fourth argument called image.
So when I create a planet, I give it a radius, a distance from whatever it's orbiting around. That O is for an orbital speed, and an image, which is its texture. So right now I could say, for example, make the sun with the sun texture. And I could say here, make every other planet with textures index 0, which was what? Mars. Let's do textures index 1 to be the Earth texture. So whenever I make any other planets, make it textures index 1, the Earth. And you know, I could run this. I missed something important. Actually, I didn't. And you can see now, look at that. Because I now have the sun as the center and all the other ones have the Earth texture. Okay, this is getting good. Now what I want to do though is have each of these have a different texture. So what I could do, where did I assign that Earth texture? It was right here. There's no reason why I couldn't get a random number. Oops, I already used R. So let's just call this index and a random number between 0 and textures.length and then have that be a random texture. So when I create the planet, the radius shrinks, the distance is random, the orbital speed is random, and the texture is a random one from the other textures I have. And if I run this again, and you can see now, I don't know why we didn't get any Earth ones. Let's run this again. There we go. So you can see now, and by the way, it's funny how I'm zooming, but I can actually just zoom in processing now because I have PZ Cam. Okay, never mind, I'm not as good at doing that. You can see that all of the planets have different textures and you can see, and it kind of creates more of it. Now, blah, 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 I've lost my ability to speak. Okay, so now we have this solar system thing. Now, there's a few more things we could add to this. Number one is, it'd be interesting to make the orbits elliptical. I'm gonna leave that as a thought experiment for anybody watching this video to discuss in the comments and maybe post a version of it. But you could think about how that radius changes as it's orbiting. It gets wider, it gets shorter based on the angle of rotation. That's something you might try. But what I want to do now is just change the lighting a little bit. I think it would be interesting to, instead of having generic lighting, to actually have the lighting come from the sun itself, right? The sun is bright, and as things are orbiting it, you can see how different parts of the planets might get the light or not get the light. And so, a way of doing, let's look in the processing reference. I honestly don't know a lot about, I have a live in fear of 3D. It's something I don't like to do because it makes, I sometimes get a stomach ache when I program things that are in 3D. But I want to go to processing and I want to go to reference and I want to look for lights. And I'm going to look here and see there's all these different functions for different kinds of lights and I encourage you to explore them. But I want to look at point light. What point light does is it adds a light, and you can see it has six arguments. The red, green, and blue value, so what color is that light, and then the coordinate of the light. Well, this is really easy. I want a bright white light from where the sun is, which is at the center. So I can actually go back to my scene now, go back to the main draw, and right here, instead of saying lights, I can say point light, bright white, and at the centers of the world, 0, 0, 0. So let's run this. I actually have not tried this. I'm just assuming that it's going to work. And look at that. You can see now. Now, interestingly enough, you can't see the sun. I kind of love this, though. The sun is not getting its own light. So I don't know how best to remedy that, but we could also try turning the generic lights on. And it's still, it's not as effective because, but I could probably shine like a spotlight on the sun or something. I don't know. I don't really mind that though. But anyway, you can see that this, the effect is not as strong. Somebody watching this video will come up with a nice way of lighting the sun and the other planets. But I like this effect of being able to see that shadowing you know, maybe we could, but what would be interesting is to actually put lights on some of the other planets to see how that works. Oh, there's all sorts of possibilities there, but I've got to stop. I think I've given you some tools here. I've given you a way of creating spheres as an object, of rotating spheres around other spheres, having those things be nested, having textures texture those spheres, and a little bit more on how you might light the scene in creative ways. So I hope you will explore this. Something else you could do is put an image as the background, maybe a star field. You can see in Andres' example how that works. I'll link to the code for that example as well in the description. But make some creative experiments with this. Think about elliptical orbits, be more thoughtful. Could you actually, you know, make sun and
the planets that are in our solar system, would you choose to include Pluto or not, or some other new planetary discoveries? Can you put a ring around Saturn? How might you do that? Oh, all sorts of interesting possibilities. So I encourage you to explore that stuff and share with me your solar system processing sketches. Okay, that was the end of that. Ambient, oh, I should have used ambient light maybe. Maybe I should have just used ambient light instead of lights, like. Or what I could have done is put it on the edge. I don't know. What does ambient light want? I don't know. It's kind of cool still. You can definitely see how it's brighter based on where the sun's shining on it. But I want to move on because it's already 12:15. I wanted to do the maze generation and some more Git and GitHub tutorials. Wow, I'm close to 50 people watching, which is very exciting. So if you just started tuning in, I just added two more video tutorials about making a 3D solar system simulation-like thing. And this is the final result of it, which is a lot of things orbiting around a lot of things with some lights and some textures. And now the next thing I want to do is do maze generation. So I'm going to show you the thing that I'm going to do next. I need to put on my Jeopardy theme music. I need to get some like while I'm waiting music. Oh, that's good. Where are applications? Applications, I want to use Atom just to see how that goes. So I'm going to put Atom in my shortcuts here. And I want to open Atom up. Quit processing, save, yes. And what I'm going to do is, let Adam do that. And then I'm going to open Coding Rainbow, Maze Challenge, open. Boy, I have two panes open. I don't want to have two panes open. That's exciting and interesting. But how do I close this pane? Window. Somebody who knows Adam, panes, split up. Focus, next pane, close pane. Okay. Close, sketch. Okay, so, and then I need to make this much bigger. How's this looking color-wise, font size-wise? Can you guys see this okay? So I'm gonna show you this example that I made earlier this morning. And so I need terminal. And I want to build this example from scratch again in a video tutorial. Okay, one thing I want to do is also make the frame rate slow. Did you hear that? That was my stomach growling. Could you hear that? This is the problem with doing these videos in the morning, and I didn't eat probably big enough breakfast. Now I'm getting hungry, and my brain is going to start to stop working. So. What's happening, I just turned the frame rate to, I turned the frame rate to 1. So this is a particular maze generation algorithm, and I'm going to find the Wikipedia page. I think this is most likely the page that I looked at. Yep, depth first search, and I basically followed exactly this particular algorithm, recursive backtracker, which is right here. Let's make this wider. There are all sorts of other algorithms which would be cool to explore in other videos. So recursive backtracker, depth first search. So basically what's happening here, is that, you can see it, that this green, this is the current cell. So it's, the maze is being generated from a grid, and basically the grid, every spot on the grid has 4 walls. And what's happening is this particular green square is the current cell, and it's moving, visiting every cell. And as it gets to a cell, it looks for neighbors that it hasn't visited before. And it picks, if it has a bunch of neighbors it hasn't visited, it
it randomly picks one of those and removes the wall and then moves. So it's like carving out, it's almost like if you imagine how subway tunnels are dug, it's like this thing carving out this tunnel. So it's carving it out. Now it keeps just doing this and moving around. Now at some point it's gonna get to a spot where it's gonna be stuck and it's like, oh, everything around me has been visited. So then it needs to go back to some other place where it was previously that has available neighbors. So all of that is kept in this structure called a stack. So you can see how this is happening very slowly. If I go back to the code and I get rid of this frame rate one and I just hit refresh, now this is doing it very, very quickly and you can see how it is carving it out. And you can see at some point it's gonna jump back to a previous spot. It's actually doing that now, it's just moving so fast. And you can see, so it's gonna visit every single spot and it's gonna like keep walking backwards and backwards and finally it's kind of solved the maze. So I don't know where the end of this maze is. I guess you could say it's the bottom right corner. But this should generate a nice labyrinth pattern and I can even, if I change this to 10, hit refresh, you can see it's gonna do it and it's slow, it's inefficient, but we get this kind of nice animation that I think you could have some creative possibilities. And you can see, I guess with the, I wonder if the slowness now is just drawing all this stuff or the slowness is actually, it's like some of the computation it's doing. I don't think it'd be the computation because each cycle of draw doesn't have to do that much. It's probably more the drawing that it's now kind of running a little bit slower. So what I'm gonna do is I need to take just a short 2-minute break and I'm gonna let this run. Oh, that's way too slow. So let this run. Let's see if I can finish my break before this finishes doing the maze. And then I'm gonna come back on and go through how to code this thing. And I don't know if I'm gonna get to the Git and GitHub stuff right now if I do this, but I'm kind of on a path here. So, okay, I'll be back in a minute. I'm muting my microphone. I think I'm unmuted now. Am I unmuted now? So you should hear me. I am coming back. I'm going to check on how that maze is doing. And then we're going to start looking at the code for this. Oh, it didn't finish yet. So I was faster than this. I'll let this run for another minute. I'm going to open up this. Oh, I forgot I have all these like console log stuff as I was debugging this earlier today. Okay, I'm just sort of looking at the chat for a minute. Just give it a white. Oh, I could have put an ambient light at the. Aaron is doing a good. I think Aaron in the chat is suggesting something about the lighting. I'll figure that out later. Okay. Okay, everybody, here we go. Let's program this. Let's go through how it works. I'm probably gonna need the whiteboard, so this is gonna be hard. I did it already today, as you can see, so that should give me a little bit of a leg up as opposed to just trying to do it from, but I'm sure I'll make lots of mistakes and get confused. I'm gonna try not to refer back to my code where it's solved.
But I need to get myself set up. So let's make another blank. So I think I'm probably going to do this in multiple parts. And so let me do this. And say maze algorithm. And in there, I'm going to say maze one. Put all this stuff in here. Sorry, I'm just sorting out how I'm going to get this going. And then I'm going to, in Atom, I'm going to remove project folder. And can I do the thing that I used to do in Sublime by just dragging this over here? Doesn't look like it. I will just say open. And then I will click here. Okay, oh, I hate seeing that hidden file, but that's okay. And then I'm going to close this one. And now I'm going to add that in. I am going to add that in. And add that in. I'm going to start with some code. And then I'm going to go back. Almost done here, everybody. Look at this beautiful maze. And I'm going to go here, here. We can see that. I also have this console here now, which we can see errors and things we need to console log. And I'm in Atom. And I think I'm ready now. So this is going to be, I might as well put some comments here. Daniel Schiffman, this is, what kind of algorithm are we calling this? This is a depth-first search. Depth-first search. And I'm also going to put in the comments recursive backtracker. And it's all coming from this page. OK. So I'm going to check the chat. And looks like I lost some viewers here. But tell everybody to come and join, because we are starting to do the maze generation now. And this is going to be in multiple parts. I think the first part is I'll just build the grid and the sort of system for the grid. And I think what I will do is, have this running. And let's, okay. So I'm trying to, it's fine. Have this running in the background as I start to talk about depth first search, recursive backtracker, generating a maze. Ooh, this would be great to do in 3D, huh? Okay. Don't forget my timer. Oh, don't forget to cycle the cameras. Hopefully, you know, that low battery light just like keeps coming on my. Yeah, I got two bars now in my microphones, but hopefully that will be good. You guys will yell and scream at me however you can manage if my audio cuts out. Okay, this live stream has now been going for an hour and 18 minutes. And I expect doing this will take about an hour, and hopefully I'm going to divide that into three like 10-minute videos. So like an hour of doing the whole thing. And so I'm committed here to staying until this is finished. And it looks like I probably won't get to more Git and GitHub tutorials today. And I'll do the next week, because I'll be back. I'm going to do two sessions next week. So, and if I don't finish this today, I'll finish it next week. Okay, so I'm going to start the first. Video. Okay. So I'm gonna have this be the anatomy of a whatever. This is still a coding challenge in multiple parts. The anatomy of a project, I feel like it should be something more concept-y, whatever. I'll figure this stuff out. It doesn't matter what I call this stuff. Okay. Start my timer. Welcome to a coding challenge about maze generation. You can see this is, start over. Recursive back depth. Okay. Depth first search recursive backtracker. Let me hit refresh. Okay. Here we go. My phone just buzzed. Okay. Turn. Oh, no, no, wait. I need the timer. See, this is the problem. Too much going on. Everybody, I apologize. Okay.
Welcome to a new coding challenge, maze generation. So I've got a maze generator running behind me. It's using something called a depth first search and a recursive backtracker. Those are all very fancy sounding names. And what I'm going to do in this challenge, probably in multiple parts, so there'll be two or three videos you can follow along in sequence, is build this simulation entirely from scratch. And it will cover a lot of concepts in object-oriented programming, thinking about arrays, thinking about something called a stack, thinking about recursion, all sorts of crazy stuff. So without further ado, so to speak, let's just get started. Ah, no, actually, there is some ado here. So this is a version of it running that I built a while ago, meaning earlier this morning. And I just want to show you where this comes from. All this will be linked to the source code for this, and this Wikipedia page will be linked to in the description. This is a Wikipedia page on maze generation. There's a lot of different algorithms if I were to just keep scrolling. I'm implementing this depth first search, and I'm actually going to implement exactly this pseudocode, which is written right here under a recursive backtracker. But if you keep scrolling down, you'll see there's various other algorithms, and maybe we'll come back, and in future videos, if you like this topic, do more of them. So this is what I want to focus on. Now, before I can even focus on really getting to the algorithm, I need to kind of like set the scene of like, what is it that we're building? So I'm going to come over here to the whiteboard. And what I'm going to have is I'm going to have a canvas. So I'm going to build this on a web page in a browser using HTML5 canvas, using P5JS. And I'm also using Atom as my text editor, some tools that I'm using here. But what I ultimately need is I need to think of this canvas as a grid. And each spot on that grid is a cell object. And essentially, what the program is going to do is it's going to figure out what walls should be removed to make a nice maze pattern. And you can sort of see what I'm doing here. If I remove certain walls, you could see now, here is sort of a maze that you want to follow. So before I can, and there's going to be a strategy for like, why do we remove certain walls to create a continuous maze, a continuous labyrinth. But the first thing I knew before I could do any of that is just sort of set myself up with some kind of data structures to figure out how to do this in the first place. So what I need is a cell object. The cell object should know where it is in this grid. It should know what column it's in and what row it's in. So every one of these spots has like a column number. 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4, and a row number, 0, 1, 2, or 3. So the cell needs to know where it is, and it also needs to know, like, what's the deal with its walls? Does it have, is the wall to the right open or closed? Is the wall to the top open or closed? To the left, open or closed? To the bottom, open or closed? So let's go and build this cell object, and I'm going to use a constructor function. So I'm back over here. This is, this is still running. We'll let that run. I'm going to come over here. This is my blank canvas with nothing in it yet. I'm going to go to my code editor. I'm using Atom. And I've set up just create canvas and background. So in this first video, all I'm going to do is get the grid there. So the first thing I want to do is write a constructor function for a cell object. So you can see, and I want to put some line breaks down here at the bottom. So this is what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to create a cell object that has an I and a J. The I being its column number, the J being its row number. So actually, let's think about how do we even know how many columns and rows there are. So I want to have some global variables. I'm going to call those columns and rows. And I also want to have another variable, which is the size. I really need a variable which keeps track of like how wide and high, how big is this square? It's going to be a square, not a rectangle. Same height, same. So I can have a single variable. I'm just going to call that variable W. And let's just say that variable is 40. So right, I have a canvas that's 400 by 400. And the width and height of each square is 40. So it's 10 rows and 10 columns and 10 rows. It's an easy way of thinking of it first. And
How do we calculate that? We say columns equals width divided by W. That's the total number of columns. The width divided by how big each one is. And rows equals the height divided by how big each one is. And I should also use the floor function to make sure I'm dealing with integers here, whole numbers. Even though I know that 400 divided by 40 is the whole number 10. But what if I have a different size canvas? And that'll just make things easier. So now that I have that, I have a cell object. Each cell gets its I and J, gets its column and row. OK, so how do I create all the cell objects? Well, I want to say for every row, go through every column. So the first row, create cell, create all these cells. The next row, create all these cells. The next row, create all these cells. That means I need a nested loop. So for I goes through all the rows. And you know what? I like to call J, I'm thinking of J as the rows, so I'm going to change that to J. And I could use the X and Y. That might even make things easier. But I'm used to I and J as my sort of names of things. So it kind of makes sense in my brain immediately. Use your whatever variables make you feel comfortable about columns and rows. That's what you should use. Maybe you can use cat and kitten or something. But anyway, and then I want to say I want to make a cell is a new cell at I, J. So this now is a nested loop that's going to make 100 cell objects, right? 10 by 10 grid. For every column, every row, make 100 cell objects, make them each know where they are. Now, where do I put those? What I need is an array. So I need an array. And I could use a two-dimensional array. Two-dimensional arrays in JavaScript, first of all, there's not really any such thing as a two-dimensional array. It's really just an array. And the things in the array are other arrays. That's a two-dimensional array. And there's some conveniences for doing that. But I think it's going to be simpler, actually, if I use a one-dimensional array. And we'll sort of talk about why and see some pieces of that as I keep going. OK, so I have a one-dimensional array, right? This list is going to store all the cell objects. And I'm going to say grid.pushCell. So all I'm doing here is I'm saying, make all of these cell objects and put them into this big array. Once I have that, in draw, I could actually then loop through all of them and display them. I'm going to call a function called show. So what this means is, what I want to do now is just see that this is working. And so what am I going to do in this cells? What I need now is a new function called show in the cell object. So I can add that here. This.show equals a function. And here I want to draw something. So where is the x coordinate for this particular cell? Well, it's at the I location, its column location times W, right? Because it's column 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4 scaled up by how big those squares are. X is this.j times w. And then, so I could just draw a rectangle at x, y at that size. And I could say stroke 255, no fill. And now if I run this, we should see, OK, so what did I miss? Cells is not defined, sketch.js line 25. OK, so the array, I called it grid, not cells. Whoops. I wonder why grid is, and this should be grid also. Okay, so that should fix that. Great. So you can see now I have that grid there. Now, we should dig a little bit deeper here, because the whole point of doing this was not to draw rectangles here. But each cell has walls. It has four walls, a top, a right, a bottom, and a left. So I should be either drawing, the walls should either be there or they shouldn't be there. So I need to draw them as individual lines. So let's figure out how I would do that. So here where I'm drawing, instead of drawing a rectangle, I want to draw the walls. So to draw the wall, I'm just going to use line. So we can get rid of the rectangle. I might want this later. So I'm going to leave that commented out. I'm going to say line what? X comma y, x plus w comma y. What's that going to give me? So you can see here that that gives me a line from the top left to the top right of each cell. Now, I could also draw from x comma y plus w to x comma y plus w. To x plus w. OK.
let's go to the whiteboard here because this will be easier to figure out if I do this here. Okay? So what's going on? Each cell, this location is x, y. This location is x plus w, comma y. This location is x plus w, y plus w. And this location is x, comma y plus w. I think I got all those right. So I need to draw a line from here to here, a line from here to here, a line from here to here, and a line from here to here. Let's do that. So that should be, and I can look back, you know, you can kind of imagine that that's there, but I'm looking back at it and I'm saying the next line is x plus w, whoops, I don't know where that came from, x plus w, comma y to x plus w, y plus w, and then I need x plus w, comma y plus w, and there's an extra. Boy, this is all doing all sorts of autocomplete stuff for me. I'm going to have to work that out in this editor. X, comma, y plus w. Oh boy, we're going to get this eventually. And then x, y plus w, back to x, y. So now if I run this, we can see, it looks just like it did before. But let's just sort of make sure things are working here. Like, what if I take out this particular line? Actually, it doesn't look any different, because if I take out the right side, the left side of the cell next to it always picks it up. But if I take out both sides, we just see only the top and the bottom. We only see the horizontal lines. Okay, I'm getting somewhere, but I got to think about this. One thing I want to do, this is me being like the anal. Anybody see the Saturday Night Live sketch, Anal Retentive Chef? Where like the garbage goes in the Ziploc bag and then that gets like, and then the Ziploc bag goes in the paper bag and the paper bag gets folded and gets taped. Well, I am the anal retentive coder, and what I want to do is just like align all of this so I can kind of like see this more easily, what's going on. And this is bothering me because I want spaces here. So you should now turn this video to 2x speed while I'm doing this. And then go back. But this, I think, is useful to be able to see exactly what's going on. And I will do this periodically. And this needs a space. Boy, what is I have just lost my mind here. And this needs a space. Oh, you know one thing I need is auto format. When I take a break to go to the next video, we'll edit this part out. Okay, so, and I need some spaces here. This is really, you should not be like me. Be like some, don't have this kind of problem. Be fine with the spacing and everything not being exactly right. You know, indentation is important, but at some point in your life, you just need to like write your code. Anyway, the reason why I did this is I want to see like, okay, I want to see clearly like this is the x coordinate, this is the y, this is the x. I wanted everything to line up nicely. Okay, now, how am I going to figure out a way? I need something else for these cells. I need you to figure out a way to know, does it have a wall on any of these sides? So what I'm going to do, this is going to be a little bit strange. I think a way of doing this is to create Boolean variables. So I have a Boolean variable for the top, for the right, for the bottom, and for the left. Top, right, bottom, left. Are there walls? Does the wall exist for this particular cell? So let's look at how I might do that. So each cell, and honestly, I think what would be easier would be to say this.walls equals true, comma, true, comma, true, comma, true. So I'm creating an array. So each cell, when it starts, every wall is there. True, 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 true. So it's up to me to memorize. Let's all memorize this together. Top, right, bottom, left. Top, right, bottom left. Stay with me. Top, right, bottom left. Okay? That's going to be the order. Did I get it right here? Top, right, bottom left. I think that's the right order. X to X plus W, Y to Y plus W, X plus W to X, Y plus W to Y. I'm pretty sure I got that right. So what I can say here now is if walls index 0, then draw this line and I'm going to repeat this a bunch of times and put in, I bet you there's a key command. This is the first time I've ever used Atom. I bet you there's a key command to auto format it. And one, and two,
And three. Now, I'm sure some of you could come up with like a case statement, or you wouldn't need the curly brackets, but I'm trying to be as explicit as possible. So these are the lines I'm going to draw if the wall exists. So you can see here, I hit refresh. Ooh, walls is not defined. So what? Of course, I made the mistake that I always make, which this needs to say this.walls in all of these. And you can see there it is. Now, if I change this to false, top, middle, right, top, right, bottom, left. I already forgot. Top, right, bottom, left. We should only see the left lines. And you can see those are all the left lines. And we can be sure about, so you can see at some point I'm going to be able to change these Boolean variables from true or false to add and remove walls based on how that labyrinth should look. Okay, so I think I've actually, this concludes this first video where essentially all I've done is set up a grid, a two-dimensional array. It's a one-dimensional array. And it has a bunch of cells that live on a grid, each with an I and a J. Each cell is drawn as four lines, top, right, bottom, left. I probably said something totally wrong before because I think I was saying middle. There's no middle. Top, right, bottom, left. Top, right, bottom, left. And I also have a mechanism, an array that has Booleans in it to know whether top is right is true, right is true, bottom is true, left is true, if those lines should be there or not. Okay, in the next video, I'm going to look at the algorithm and see how we start from one of those cells and decide whether to remove a wall or not. And that will start us with actually the maze creation itself. Okay, so that was like 16 minutes just making those objects. There is a package called auto indent, but did I say middle? Was I saying it wrong? Beautify package. There is a package called auto indent. Key binding is Command Shift I. Let's see about that. Command Shift I. Okay, so I don't have it. How do I install a package? Package. Whoa, look at all this. How do I install a package? I don't want to waste too much time. Auto format atom. Auto indent in the atom editor. How do you auto indent? Atom text editor, command alt L editor, auto indent. Open your key map. Edit lines, auto indent. Oh, edit lines. Auto indent. Let's see if that works. Edit lines auto indent. That didn't work. All right, maybe we'll worry about this too much. Command, go to preference, command plus. Oh, settings. Auto indent, automatically indent the cursor, auto indent on paste, editor settings, invisible settings. Ooh, I like seeing that. Line height, non-word, scroll pass, and show indent guide. I like seeing that. Tab length, tab tight. Install and search for auto indent. And install to find the package you need. Well, I don't know where I find packages. Update, install. Auto indent. Auto dash indent. Auto indent. This package, okay, install. Here we go. This is exciting moment here. Is it working? Is it installing? Uninstall, disable. That seems like it did it, right? And then, what do I do? Command Shift I. Hey, look at that. I would like it to also put spaces like there automatically, but I'll live without that for right now. I'd like to be fully auto formatted. Okay, great. So now I can just do Command Shift I. I'm going to have to learn that. I'm like programmed to do Command T, Command T, Command T, because that's the auto format and processing. Okay, I can install a P5JS package. I don't know if I want to do that just yet. I'll do that later. Okay, so what I need to start doing now is beautify. Oh, beautify package does that. Okay, let's look at beautify. Uh, Beautify might ruin some of my other stuff, though. Jade Beautify, is that what I want? Adam Beautify? Maybe I want Adam Beautify. Look at that. A million people downloading this one. Let's do that.
I don't know what that's going to do. Is there a key command associated with this? This is me learning a new text code editor live on the fly.
Let's see. Did it install? I'm still waiting. Okay, so I'm not going to, I don't want to waste too much time doing that. So let me look back now. And we've got, is this really still? Oh, you know what it is?
I'm pretty sure that when I, the window, the tab loses focus, it stops animating. It's supposed to do that. Because why should it be animating if you're not looking at it? So that's why it hasn't finished this. But whatever. Now, here we are. We're in here. And so now what I need to do is look at this algorithm. And we need to pick a current cell and look at its neighbors and check and see if any of the neighbors have not been visited. And then remove the wall. Okay. Boy, there's a lot more to do, but once we do it, it's going to be very exciting.
Okay. So I have that open. I have this. I have this is our reference for the algorithm. And this is me doing various package thingies. So Adam Beautify is in there now. Is there a key command? Control-Alt-B. Wait. Control. So I'm on a Mac. So what's that? Control-Command? Ooh, ugh. I don't like what it did there. No, I don't want two indents there. That's terrible. Undo. Probably messed with this too. Ooh, it did something there. Okay. I'll worry about the Beautify settings later. But now at least I have auto indent, which is Command Shift I, right? I mean, Command Shift I. Yep.
Okay. Command Shift I, Command Shift I, Command Shift I, Command Shift I.
Okay. I don't want an else if statement here because I want to do all of these. Somebody suggested. So, by the way, somebody suggested in the chat that I should make an else if statement here.
This should not be an else if statement here because I'm not just doing one of these. I'm figuring out which ones it needs to do. I could make this look a lot less long-winded by removing the curly brackets since each if just gets one line. But anyway, okay. So let's move on, and we're going to keep going with this. So I'm now about to start part two. It is, ooh boy, it's almost 1 o'clock. Part two might be it. I might do the whole thing. I'm trying to think of like what I would segment in. But I think possibly, yes, you know what? I'm going to do the stack in part three. So I'm actually going to do part one without keeping track of like going back. And when there's nothing left, it'll just stop and be stuck. That's what I'm going to do. So two more parts. Okay, so we don't have to discuss what a stack is and how that works in this particular video, but there's a lot to do in this video in terms of removing walls and that sort of thing. Okay, top, right, bottom, left, top, right, bottom, left. Here we go. All right, let me cycle the cameras. I want to make sure there's not a battery that only has one bar, because if there's a battery that only has one bar, I'm in big trouble. Okay, here we go. Boy, I used a blue pen at one point. Okay, here we go. 51 people watching. I should check Twitch. There's a few people. There's 20 people watching in Twitch. Some people are asking, yeah, oh, once I finish this live stream, I mean, these videos will get edited into separate videos on YouTube. The code will get posted. There will be links to the code. All of that will be there. But now I'm going to go into part two. Here we go. Okay. Here you are. Hello. Energy. I don't have any coffee today or tea. I need to get some more chamomile tea. Okay. Here we go. 50 people watching. Hello, world. We're going to do part two. We're going to start implementing this algorithm. And I'm going to start speaking about it. part two of my depth first search recursive backtracker maze generation demonstration algorithm thing. Here we are. So all I did so far, this is what I'm trying to build. This thing that's going to take some time and eventually generate this beautiful, hopefully it will be beautiful, although mine won't be so beautiful. You'll take my code and make something more beautiful. But I'm going to show you how to make this maze generation thing. Now, just to recap, all we have so far is just this grid. So I have this grid, and in the code, I have cell objects. Each cell knows where it is, what's its column, what's its row, and it knows whether to draw its walls. Top, right, bottom, left. Top, right, bottom, left. And it has a Boolean variable to keep track of which walls are currently active in there. So we need to now go and look at that Wikipedia page where the algorithm is described. So I'm going to go over here and look at this. This is the algorithm working, recursive backtracker. So the whole backtracking aspect, that's going to be in part three. But we're going to do the forward tracking aspect. So the first thing here is that make the initial cell the current cell and mark it as visited. OK, so this is a really key concept. What's going to happen here is that the program is going to start on a given cell. And it's going to start walking around the cells and just deciding whether or not it should remove a wall or keep the wall there. Now, as it walks around the cells, it should never go back and visit a cell that it's already been at. So we need a variable to keep track of whether a cell has been visited or not. So if I come back over here, that's the very first thing I want to add, is I want to add another variable here that says this.visited equals false. So each cell should not be visited. So the first starts as having not been visited. Sorry. Now, in the main part of the program, what I want now also to have is I'm going to have a variable called current. So this variable current is the current cell. This is the cell that is currently being visited. And in setup, we could just have it be current equals grid index 0. So I'm going to start the current cell just at 0 in the top left. It could be anywhere. It could start in the middle, it could start at the bottom right. This has to do with where you want your maze to begin and end. But for now, I'm not really going to worry about it so much. Starting at grid index 0 will be just fine. And then in draw, the very first thing I'm going to do is say current.visited equals true. Now, I think there would be something useful here to do. For example, what I just to be able to see best, it would also be really useful for debugging. And remember, I kept this in here, is that we could have, put some spaces here, if the cell has been visited, let's change its color a little bit so that we can sort of see what's going on. So I'm going to say, if this.visited, draw a rectangle. I'm going to get good at this someday. Draw a rectangle with so much. I want to turn off that autocomplete in between this video and the next one. Make it a nice like purplish color with a little bit of alpha. So what we'll see here if I run this again, oh, that's the wrong one here, is we can see this cell has been visited. Just that first cell is now kind of a purplish color. OK, so now we've got a structure for knowing if a cell has been visited. And we're also, debugging-wise, can see if it's been visited by highlighting it, which will help us as we try to figure out if the program is working or not. So let's now go and look at the algorithm and what's next. While there are unvisited cells. OK, so as long as there are unvisited cells, so we know that we're going to be finished when all the cells have been visited. We'll worry about that later. If the current cell has any neighbors which have not been visited, OK, this is probably going to be a pretty complicated piece. We need to figure out, does the current cell have any neighbors which have not been visited? So let's figure out how we're going to do that. I'm going to go back to my code, which is over here, and come back. And what I want to do is say something like current.check neighbors. Whoa, how did it know that's what I was going to type? That's crazy. That is insane. It's like predicting the future. It's got some kind of like deep learning, machine learning magic. I wasn't even using this editor earlier. I did type something earlier today that said check neighbors. I don't know what's going on. Some sort of magic. OK, maybe I opened up a different example already. Whatever. The point is, I want to write a function that's called check neighbors. So I'm going to add that function. This.check neighbors, now it should know, is a function. So how do I check the neighbors? OK, let's think about this. First of all, I'm in a real place, and there could be neighbors outside. Neighbors are people that are to the right, the left,
in front of me, etc. Let's look at how that works over here. So much like we were talking about in the previous video, the top, right, bottom, and left walls, now if I have a cell, there are four neighbors. If this cell is at I, j, this is I plus 1, j. This is I minus 1, j. This is I, j minus 1. And this is I, j plus 1, right? Y goes up by 1, down by 1. I goes up by 1, down by 1. So this is what we want to check the neighbors. We need to know, are any of these neighbors visited or unvisited? OK. So let's start doing that. I'm going to come back over here and say something like, so I'm going to make an array called neighbors. And I'm going to say right equals grid. And now this is where it would be nice if I was using a two-dimensional array. And you know what? I want to start with top. Remember? Top, right, bottom, left. This is how I'm always going to track everything. So the top is grid. You would sort of think of it as like this. Right? If I had a two-dimensional array, I would say j minus 1. That's the cell above me. Right? But I don't have a two-dimensional array. I have a one-dimensional array. There is a magic formula. The magic formula to get an index into a one-dimensional array where everything 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, where everything is ordered going across rows, but I want to think of the column and row coordinate, is as follows. Index equals I plus j times the number of columns. I will link to a separate video about pixels where I go through this algorithm specifically if you haven't seen it before. But for now, you can sort of trust me that that works. So what I'm really saying here is this. I'm saying I want this particular right neighbor. Oh, that's not the right neighbor. That's the top neighbor, right? I want to check, is that top neighbor visited or not? Now, because I'm going to need this formula so many times in this program, I'm going to write a function, and I'm going to call it index. An index gets an I and a j and just returns I plus j times the number of columns. So I can actually just do this. I don't need this code here. I could say the top neighbor is index I j minus 1. The right neighbor is I plus 1j. And you know what? I'm going to live dangerously today, and I'm not going to fix all the formatting here. I'll fix it after the fact when I post the code. It'll be all nicely indented and spaced the way I like it. But I'll fix a few things. Right, bottom. I can't help it. I'm doing it anyway. Index bottom is ij plus 1, and then left is grid I minus 1, j, what, j, I'm losing my mind here, I minus 1, j, right? Because the y is the same. OK, so these are the neighbors, top, right, bottom, left. Now, first of all, have they been visited? If top has been visited, if top has not been visited, then I want to add top to that array. Neighbors.push top. Now I should really probably condense that. Right now I'm doing something that I do often, which is like I'm just writing things out very explicitly. I know there's only four neighbors, and I could just like have these four neighbors and then duplicate this code four times. I could easily do it differently and kind of like figure out a nice way of like condensing this code, but I'm going to just sort of live with being happy with this, because I'm just going to do this four times and do if bottom has not been visited, put it in. If right has not been visited, put it in. And if left has not been visited, put it in. And you know what? I want to keep the same order, even though it doesn't matter. Yeah, it does. It might matter. Top right bottom left. Top right bottom left. So I want to build an array of things that have not been visited yet. But I also have a little bit of an issue I need to deal with. It's really unfortunate. I wish I didn't have this problem. But what if I'm over here? I only have three neighbors. There's no neighbor to over here. And I could do something fancy where if you go over here, you could come on that side. But I don't want to do that. So I also need to figure out to make sure
my the neighbor that I'm looking for is not negative one or past the width. So I need to deal with that. Ugh, I wish I didn't have to. Life would be so much nicer if we didn't have these edge cases. By the way, that's why you call edge case, because it's actually on the edge. It's an edge case. I'm doing something different for it. I don't know if I ever thought about that before, but you know. So one way I can deal with that is I think, I'm going to do it over here. This is a little bit weird, but I'm going to say because it's invalid, I want an invalid index if I or j is less than, right, if I is less than 0 or j is less than 0 or I is greater than the number of columns, minus 1, or j is greater than the number of rows, minus 1. All of these are invalid index values, right? I has to be between 0 and columns minus 1. J has to be between 0 and rows minus 1. And then I'll just return a negative 1. So I'm going to get a totally invalid index. Otherwise, I want the correct index. And then down here, do you know if it gets negative 1, do you know what's going to happen here? Top is going to be undefined, or right is going to be undefined, or bottom is going to be undefined. So you know what I can just do? As long as top is a real thing and it hasn't been visited, then it can go into the array. As long as right is a real thing and it hasn't been visited, as long as bottom is a real thing and it hasn't been visited, and as long as left is a real thing and it hasn't been visited. Boy, this check neighbors function is a lot to do, but we're kind of like, we're really like practically there now. What we have figured out now is, are there neighbors that haven't been visited? If so, select randomly one of those. So now what I want to do is if neighbors is dot length is greater than 0, let's pick a random neighbor. So I need a random value between 0 and the length of that array. And then I'm going to say return that random neighbor. Otherwise, let's just return undefined. It probably would return undefined anyway if it doesn't return a neighbor, but I'm going to explicitly say undefined. So this is what we're doing. We are in a cell, that's the current cell. We're looking at all its neighbors. We're finding any that haven't been visited, and then we're going to visit that one. So let's go back to the main sort of part of the sketch. And what I'm going to do here is say neighbor equals current check neighbor. So this function should check the neighbors, find a random unvisited one, and return it. And I'm going to say if neighbor is not undefined, right, then what? Neighbor, and you know what? I'm not going to call this neighbor. I'm going to call this next, because this is really the next cell. Current, the next cell is one of the available neighbors. As long as neighbor is not defined, now next is not defined. Now next has been visited. And current should be next, right? So this is like what we're doing. We're marching through. So let's just look at this. If I run this now, I probably made a mistake. So check neighbors is not, current.check neighbors is not a function. So let's see, what did I miss? Current check neighbors. This check neighbor, I spelled neighbors wrong. Okay, so now let's run this again. Look at that. So you can see, and now let's reduce the frame rate so we can see what's going on. I'm going to say frame rate just at 5 frames per second. So you can see here it's marching along, and eventually it's going to get to a spot, and there's no more available neighbors. So we're doing pretty well, and actually this is going to be the end of this part, because we got to a good part. We got the part of the algorithm where we're marching along to find neighbors until we get to a spot where there's no neighbors anymore. Now, I haven't been removing the walls. Removing the walls I'm going to do in the next part. But this is pretty good. I can hit refresh again, and we can see it's going to do this differently every time, but you can see it's going to get stuck pretty fast. So the next thing I need to do is in the algorithm is actually start removing the walls so that we're carving out this maze, so to speak. Okay, see you in the next video. Okay, so lots of people are discussing in the chat. I got 49 people watching. That was good. Okay, so I like this dividing this up into parts thing, because it gives me a moment to just take a breath. And the next part should be pretty easy, which is just removing the walls, which I said it's easy and it won't be. So
I'm going to skip this, remove the wall between the current cell and chosen cell. So all I did was part one and four. Choose randomly one of the unvisited neighbors, make the chosen cell the current cell, and mark it as visited. So I should have looked at that. I kind of just assumed that while I was making the video, but that's fine. I'm going to clarify that as I do the next one. Okay. So here we go. And I'm going to come back and do part three in a second. Anybody have any questions or things you want to mention in the chat? I keep setting this timer and I keep forgetting to unset it and I have no idea. I'm going to reset these cameras. By the way, I got some notification that it is now exactly 8 years ago that I started my Twitter account. I'm like, Pebble Watch is tweeting at me. Boy, it's 1:12. Well, I was going to finish at 1 today. This all stuff always takes longer. But I want to finish this series on the, and I guess I'm not going to do the GitHub stuff today. Can I make this a hexagon maze after the next video? That is a great suggestion. I will not be doing that. This has got to be pretty similar to the Langston's ant thing. Maybe I'll try to tie that in or something at some point. Okay, part three, which will be removing the walls. And here we go. Part three of my maze generating thingamabob. So this is what I'm trying to create. I've done two parts so far. You can see where we are right now is that I start with a cell and I start marching through and picking. Start over. Okay. Welcome to part three of my maze generation project. What is it? What kind of algorithm is it again? Depth first search. Welcome to part three of my depth-first search, recursive backtracking, magic maze-generating algorithm in the browser using p5.js project. So this is what I'm trying to make, and where I am so far is kind of along the way there. You can see this something similar is happening here, where I'm starting with a cell in a grid, and I move to a cell next to it, and then I move to a cell next to it, and I move to a cell next to it, and I never go back and move to a cell that has already been visited, the visited cells being highlighted in purple. So what are the next steps? Let's go to our Wikipedia page that had the algorithm very nicely laid out for us, and we can kind of see what we've done so far. So by the way, we're on part one right now. Part one, if the current cell has any neighbors which have not been visited, we did that already. What? Choose randomly one of the unvisited neighbors. We've done that already. Skip step two, skip step three, step four. Make the chosen cell the current cell and mark it as visited. So all I've done so far in building this is step one and four. So I'm just moving from cell to cell to cell to cell, not revisiting any cells. Now, step two, push the current cell to the stack. This is something I'm going to visit in the next video. What is the stack? Why do I have to keep track of a stack? What does that all mean? I'm going to get to that. This video, I'm going to work on part three. Remove the wall between the current cell and the chosen cell. The chosen cell. Who is the chosen cell? Okay, let's figure out how we're going to do that. We've got to like figure out in the code where that is or what we're even talking about. So we already have the pieces of this somewhere. So here we are. This is the thing running. Here is our code. Let's go down to the cell object. And we can see here's one thing. So each cell object has an array called walls with four true variables in it. True, top, right, bottom, left. Top, right, bottom, left. So let's say the two cells are next to each other. One is to the left and one is to the right. One of them needs to remove its right wall, so that would become false. And the other one needs to remove its left wall, and that would become false. I got to draw a diagram here to understand this. So let me come over this. This is tricky. And I think we can just get rid of this larger grid now. We kind of understand that. So this is what I mean. There's really four scenarios. Right? This is the cell, and this is the neighbor. This is the cell, and this is the neighbor, right? So this is the wall that needs to be removed. The cell needs its right wall removed. The neighbor needs its left wall removed.
Here, the cell needs its bottom wall removed, the neighbor needs its top wall removed. How do we know which is which? Well, if this is I and this is I plus one, right, the difference between, you know, one cell's, you know, like cell index I minus neighbor index I, right, that'll tell us if it's to the right or the left. Because if this is I is 45 and this I is 46, and we take 45 minus 46, we are going to have what? Negative 1. So if we get negative 1, that means we have a neighbor to the right. So let's sort of, I'm tripping over lights and things. Let's start looking at that in our code. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to write a new, let's look in the program, where are we? We're right here in the algorithm, right? This is step 1. And this is step 4, according to that Wikipedia page, right? Step 1 is mark it as visited, and step 4 is set it to be the next one. Actually, step 1 is really here. Pick a random neighbor. Pick a random neighbor, mark it as visited, and step 4 is current equals the next one. So what I need to do is implement step 2, which, if you recall, is, not step 2, step 3, which is remove the wall between the current cell and the chosen cell. So I want to do something. And you know what? I'm going to make that in a separate function. It already knows what I'm going to type. Isn't that insane? Remove walls and between what? Current and next. Right? We need to figure out current and next. I want to remove the wall in between them. So now I just sort of thought of a function that's going to, and I could say a current dot remove walls next, but I'm just going to put it in a function. I'm going to pass them the two cells, figure out how they are in relation to each other, and remove their walls. So I can just go all the way to the bottom of my code now and work on this somewhere else. So I'm going to say function remove walls A, B. So I just have two, whoops, come on. When I hit save, it wants to get rid of all my white space on the bottom. But I want white space on the bottom. White space. Because I want to type it in here. Okay, so I want a generic function that takes two cells and removes the wall in between them, cell A and cell B. So what do I need to do? The first thing I need to do, I'm going to call x be a.i minus b.i. So this is exactly what I'm doing. The value x is the difference between this cell and that cell. So let's think about this scenario, where this is cell 46, and this is cell column 45. This is A index I, B index I, A index I minus B index I is 1. So if x is greater equals 1, that means A dot walls what? Okay, come back over here. I want the left wall to be removed. Top, right, bottom, left. 0, 1, 2, 3. So I want A's wall index 3 to be false. And now B should have its right wall moved, removed. Top, right, bottom, left. 0, 1, A, B dot walls index 1 equals false. Else, if x equals negative 1, then I want to say, then the inverse of that, right? If it's negative 1, then I want the right of A and the left of B to be removed. That's pretty good, right? This makes sense. And I'm going to use triple equals to be kind of more serious about, I'm very serious about my equals. I believe in as many equal signs as possible to be sure we know what's going on. So that should work. Now I need to do the same thing with y. And so y is what? A dot j minus b dot j. And I'm going to do exactly the same thing. And say, now if y is 1 or y is negative 1. And now, OK, so let's think about this. Let's say, I think we can figure this out without a diagram, but I'm going to do it anyway. So let's say this is y, and it is row 30. And this is A. And this is B, and it is row 29. So A dot j minus B dot j is 1. So if that's the case, if A dot j minus, then A needs its top removed, and B needs its bottom removed. OK, coming back over here.
A needs its top, B needs its bottom. 0, 1, 2. So A needs its top, B needs its bottom. Here, A needs its bottom and B needs its top removed. I think we've got this right. There's only one way to find out. And we are going to now call, did I already call remove walls in the right spot? Right here. Yeah. So here we go. Let's just try it. It should, when those go false, we shouldn't see the lines anymore. Let's just see how it goes. Whew. Huh. So I don't seem to be seeing anything happening here. So what's going on? What did I miss? Still kind of marching along, but I'm still seeing the walls being drawn. So what did I miss here? So first of all, let's just make sure this is happening. And so, okay, so that function's being called. All right, so what am I missing in that function? Let's look at what x is. Oops, console.log. Let's look at what this value of x is. -1, 0, 1, -1, 0, 1. So that should be, that seems to be giving me numbers that are the right idea. So let's just see, let's just log the object here. Okay, yep. So now I'm going to look at one of these and look at the walls array. So 0 and 3 got turned to false. So this is working. Like, stuff is happening here, right? You can see, by the way, this is like a nice way of debugging. I can look at each object. I can see its walls array. So what did I miss? Probably maybe something in the actual cell object. Oh, you know what I bet you is happening? Oh, I bet you, what a silly little problem, that I forgot to say no stroke here. So the rectangle that I'm drawing to highlight the ones that have been visited always has its stroke, so it draws the full rectangle no matter what. So I think that should be it. There we go. So we can see now, as it's moving, the walls are being removed. Oh, beautiful. Oh, come on, give me a longer sequence here. Now, one thing I would like to do also, just to like keep the highlighting stuff going, is let's just go back to the main program, and I'm going to call at the end here a current highlight. So I also want to be able to see which one is current. This is just a little, we're really done with this part, but I just want to visually add something that I think will help us. So in the object, I'm going to add a function called this highlight. And what do I want to do? I want to draw yet another rectangle, no stroke. And I will color it some green color with some alpha and draw a rectangle x, y with the same size. So I just wanted to add that really quickly and refresh this now. So now we can see also which one is the current cell. Okay, great. So here's the thing. This is actually working now, and it's making our maze. Ooh, I just love it. Look, we can see our maze. The problem is it gets to a certain part. It's like trying to figure out this maze, and it's done. It needs to go all the way back and break out somewhere else. Like, it needs to go backtrack now, and maybe once it gets to here, or actually all it needs to do is go here and then start going this way, because that turned out to be a dead end. So it can start going this way. So this is where the backtracking comes in, right? This is where, in the algorithm, part two comes in. Push the cell to the current stack, and then if the stack is not empty, pop a cell, make it the current cell. So I need to discuss that. I need to unpack that, figure out that's a confusing piece. This involves a lot of additional concepts. I'm going to do that in the next video. So right now, if you're following along and building this, you should at least, though, have this much done. And just for fun, before I end this video, let's make this like 10, and let's like make it go fast now and hit refresh, and just so we can see, like, we can see this is really doing something now. Like, it's actually like just carving out this maze, and with a sort of finer degree of detail, it's going to be a while longer before it finally gets stuck. But okay, so you see that we're almost there, and we're going to go to the backtracking in the next video. Okay, see you there. Okay, everyone. Langston's fly. Minecraft. Someone has Minecraft? Just talking about, oh, there's a Minecraft version. I would love to do this kind of like maze generation in, oh, that would be so fun to make a maze generation mod in Minecraft, and then you could just like build a maze that you would then have to like walk through. I know, I don't have enough time. I really want to do Minecraft modding, actually, because I've kind of been into it recently, but I wanted to make a processing add-on. If anyone wants to help me with that, send me a tweet, because if you've done Minecraft modding in Java, I would like to make a processing tool or mode that allows you to write mods and then launch Minecraft. I just haven't had time to look into that. Okay, any questions now? I'm going to do part 4. Boy, lots of Twitter notifications, which I don't need to be looking at. Command blocks. Oh, that's an interesting way. Command. So I need to learn. I should just learn how to do that and do some of these algorithms in Minecraft with command blocks, I guess. Okay. So now what I want to do is I want to get rid of the console logging. Now I think I'm going to do something here during the. I want to just move this to a separate file, because I have too much code in this one file. So I'm going to create new file, and I'm calling it cell.js. And then in index.html, I'm going to also refer to cell.js. And I should have the same exact program. And I'm going to here now, let's make this 20. This is good. So this, I think, is a good resolution to work with. Okay, so we need to do the backtracking using a stack. And I still have some of the console logging going on here. Where did I have the console log? Oh, in the main program? Here it is. Let's get rid of that. Get rid of that and open this up. And let's copy this into here. Okay, here we go. I am just about ready. Part 4, the very last part. What do I need to do? I need to talk about what a stack is. What does it mean to be a stack? And I'm sure I could actually use some kind of fancy JavaScript stack thing, but I'm just going to use an array and the push and pop functions. And then implement it. Okay. You have access to Minecraft Pi version with Python and a Raspberry Pi. Okay. All right, here we go. So I am, ready for part 4. I keep hitting save for no reason. And I'm going to do part 4 now. I can't get myself to use a timer. I just need to have like a more automatic way of doing that, but that's okay. Okay. Boy, this was a complicated problem, right? And it would have been interesting to try this. Like, I spent a half an hour this morning, I would say between 10 and 10:30, I read the Wikipedia page and made this, and then now I am doing it again. Okay, I'm back with sound. Boy, these rechargeable batteries really suck because I had them fully charged when I started. I guess 2 hours is their limit. So when did that happen? I'm definitely going to facepalm. You're absolutely right. I have to go back, find, I've lost the chat. Oh, show chat. Okay, when did that happen? It definitely happened. Oh boy, did it happen right at the beginning of this? Do I need to do the whole thing over again? Oh, it must have happened at the beginning. So that whole sequence. Before I started recording this part, oh no! Okay, fine, I'll do it again. Ah, it was kind of short. So that's so sad. I loved my diagram and everything. I should you know what I should really do is I should dub it. That would be really funny. I should like section out the like no sound part and just like dub it in like a different language even or something. Okay, everybody. So the good news is this was kind of short and kind of easy. I have to like recreate my enthusiasm for solving it again. Yeah, epic facepalm is right. I wonder if I could build some kind of alarm like system when the sound goes off. I can't believe that happened before I started. I didn't check the chat. Okay, so hold on. Let me just go back. I don't think I did anything here. So I'm just going to do undo. You know, I made some weird mistakes, so those weird mistakes won't be in the final version. Sorry, everybody. Yes. Let's see where I am. Okay. And let's make this 20. It's funny, I saw the corner of my eye, like what do you call those, emojis? And I thought people were just excited that I got it working. Instead, you're trying to tell me there is no sound. Want me to hold the boom mic, yeah. I just need to get a new set of, I'm using rechargeable batteries to try to be more eco-conscious, and they're just not, they don't last that long. It's okay, that was short and I can do that again. If that's the worst thing that happens today, my life is fine. Okay. So, let's see here. Now the one issue is, how long was that? How long did I take to do that? Like 5, 10 minutes? This still says 2 bars. I'm gonna go and, charge, so I'm just going over to actually put these batteries in the charger just in case. Okay, and I really have to finish. It's too bad because I need to go, but I committed to finishing this. Now this is now a very long 2.5 hour stream. Okay. It's very hot in here. For part 3, I'm going to wear my People Doing Strange Things with Software t-shirt. So hold on for a moment. No, don't worry, I'm not disrobing or doing anything. Well, I don't know. Uncouth, if that's even a word. Okay, I'm just going to just wear a t-shirt for this. Because I am a person doing strange things with software. Sound is still good, and here we go. Can you please include sound in your challenges? Maybe cycle the cameras too, just in case. Okay, you guys are very kind. And I'm over here, by the way, I'm gonna erase my diagram since I'm gonna redraw it. and have my pen ready. Sound is good, it's still working. And oops, I gotta come back over here. And here we go. What am I, part four again? Ugh, so painful. So painful, but I can do it. Okay. Okay, do it in person while Sean got. All right, I'm enjoying your comments in the chat a little too much. Here we go. Here we go, everybody. I am committed to finishing this set of tutorials today, no matter how many times the mic cuts out and I have to redo it. Part four, again, Sisyphus. I am Sisyphus. I can't remember this, what it's called again. I don't know why I can't. Depth first search. Here we go. Am I in the right spot? Yep. Can I make this a little bit bigger? Actually, just, no. Let's leave it what it was. Okay, here we go. Here we go, here we go, here we go. Part four of depth first search, recursive backtracking, maze generation algorithm. This is the last part, the final part. By the end of this particular video, we will have finished this exact simulation and be drawing a full maze, and hopefully you will come up with some creative ideas and things you could do with it. So where are we so far? So this is what we've got so far. If I hit refresh, you can see we have this cell that's marching around the grid, removing walls, and eventually it gets stuck because there's no cell that it hasn't visited already around it. This is where backtracking comes in. While it's marching around, it needs to keep track of where it's been previously, so when it gets stuck, it could go back to a spot that still had available places for it to go. This is the backtracking aspect. So there's a lot of pieces to this. And so let's look at the algorithm and actually see what it says. So look at this. What have we done so far? So choose randomly one of the unvisited neighbors. If I go to the code and if I go to the part where we are, I've done that. This is me choosing randomly one of the unvisited neighbors. Now, push the current cell to the stack. This is what I'm going to implement in this video. Remove the wall between the current cell and the chosen cell. I've done that. Make the chosen cell the current cell and mark it as visited. Done that. So actually, all that we need to do is add this step number two and then this other case down here for what we're actually doing with the stack. And this is actually going to be quite easy. And actually writing the code, I'm going to just only add like four lines of code to this program and suddenly it's going to be working. But before I can add those lines of code, what I would like to discuss to you is what is this thing called a stack? And what do I need it for? So a stack is a, I have a little like issue where I'm allergic to the word computer science, and if I say it, I get like a little bit congested. But stack is really kind of a term from computer science, so to speak. So what do I mean by that? So if you're watching this video, you are probably familiar with the idea of an array, right? I'm sorry, like if I'm hungry, I'm tired, but I'm going through with this, right? This idea of an array is like a list of things, and each spot in the array has an index. This is a data structure. It keeps track of a bunch of things in a linear list, each with an index. A stack is another kind of data structure to keep track of information. And a stack is a data structure that acts very much like a stack of things, a stack of paper. You could imagine you in olden times, times of yore, when people had inboxes and outboxes that were actually physical things, you'd be sitting at your desk and people would keep coming in and adding things to your stack of paper. So things are getting pushed into the stack, added on top, on top, on top. Now, you then arrive to work and you see your stack of paper. What's the first item you're going to work on? The thing on the top, the last thing added to the stack. That is referred to as popping, so taking things out of the stack. This is sort of a strange idea. The last thing in is the first thing out. This is the polar opposite of this idea of a queue, right? If there is a, I'm about to draw a tickets booth, right? If there is a tickets booth with a ticket salesperson, I don't want to go too far with this, and then you could imagine a queue of people waiting in line to buy tickets. I probably spelled that wrong, but whatever. The first person in line, right? If your people are lining up, kind of like pieces of paper piling up on a stack, is the first person to get tickets, right? You would never sell tickets to the last person in line. But a stack, we're not using a queue in this particular project. We're using a stack, the idea of the last thing in is the first thing out. So how do you program a stack? Well, there's all sorts of different ways we could do it, but honestly, I'm just actually going to use a JavaScript array. Because a JavaScript array has a push function, which adds things to it. And in fact, I'm pretty sure we'll find out when we write the code, it also has a pop function. And the pop function allows you to pop things off. So even though an array has all sorts of features like indexes and things can be added and deleted from the middle, we're not going to use any of that. We're just going to use an array to keep this stack of objects that we push in and pop stuff out. So hopefully that clears up for you, if you haven't heard about a stack before, what that is. And now let's look at number two here. Push the current cell to the stack. Let's add this to our code. So I'm going to go over here to the code. One thing I should mention is I moved the cell constructor function to a separate file, cell.js, just to keep things organized a little better. So when you go download the code, you'll see that. And I'm about to sneeze. We'll see what happens if I make it through the rest of this video. So now I want to create a stack. So I'm just going to make it an array and make a global variable called stack, and I'm going to set it to be an empty array. If I look at the algorithm again, item two, push the current cell to the stack. Let's go back to the code. And where do I do that? Step two is right here. It's not there. I'm going to add it. Step two. And I'm going to say stack.push current. So there we go. There's very little code to write here. Push the current cell to the stack. I have done it. Now, let's figure out the next piece. So this here, we need to deal with. Now, remember, when do we suddenly need to make use of that stack? We're carving out this maze. We are like a digger thing going underneath the earth and carving a tunnel. And at a certain point, we get stuck. We have to backtrack and find a spot that we kept track of in our stack to try going a different direction. So we want to go and use the stack when we get stuck. When do we get stuck? We get stuck if there are no available neighbors. Remember, this check neighbors function returns undefined if it has no neighbors that it can give back to you. So if next is not undefined, do all that normal stuff. Otherwise, now we're stuck. Let's go and make use of the stack. So what's the first thing that we do? Oh, but it says else if stack is not empty, right? We can only use the stack if it's not empty. So here I should say else if stack.length is greater than 0. It's an array, so we can check the length is greater than 0. That's how we know if it's not empty. What? Pop a cell from the stack. Var cell equals stack.pop. This is when we find out if JavaScript arrays have a pop function. I know that they do. I'm being facetious here, because I recorded this video earlier, but the sound didn't work, and now I'm redoing it. You don't need to know that, because you're watching this sometime in the future when robots have overtaken you anyway, and you're a robot watching this. Hopefully not. Maybe. Anyway. pop a cell from the stack and make it the current. Someone in the comments is going to complain that I'm off track, but I'm back on track. Pop a cell from the stack and make it the current cell. Current equals cell, right? And you know what? What am I making this two lines of code for? All I want to do is basically say, if we're stuck, go to the stack, and we've got a new current spot. So there we go. And guess what? I'm pretty sure that we've now made this work. Because notice how it's not getting stuck anymore. Because when it gets stuck, it goes back. Now, it's happening so fast, it's sort of hard to see what's happening. But you can see that it's eventually, and the sound is still working, that it's going to revisit every single spot. Now, I'm not going to add too much more to this. This is basically done. And you can see eventually it's going to find its way back to the beginning, and it sort of solved the maze. And now it's a maze that you could actually work with and do other things with. I might, if I were you, trying to add some stuff to this, you know, as an exercise, you might try highlighting the cells a different color that are currently in the stack. You know, another thing I could do this really quickly is I could set the frame rate again to something slower. And here now we might be able to see, like, oh, we might be able to like pinpoint the moment it gets stuck and goes back. I'm watching. It doesn't seem stuck yet. We're not getting lucky here. Come on, get stuck, get stuck. Ooh, there's a lot of room for it to go. Get stuck, get stuck, get stuck, get stuck. Just my luck. Okay.
It probably, and it got stuck, and you can see how it's backtracking and going a different way. And now look, it's backtracking again, moving along that stack and finding a different way. Now it's backtracking again. So you can see, now you can see what it's doing. So you could sort of slow it down to watch this process. You know, you might sort of see like, how does this work, you know, with a much lower resolution and like a, I mean, this is kind of crazy what I'm about to do. It's probably gonna run really slow. So this is a drawing problem. Like, you know, I could sort of generate this whole like super high resolution maze. I mean, you really can, you know, I might move to processing for this, and I could render out a PDF of the maze, and I could have a website where people just log on and get infinitely generated mazes sent to them. What kind of creative things could you do with this in terms of color and application and that sort of thing? So I hope you will continue to explore that. Send me your questions in the comments, share with me things you make from this. But this, I think, really concludes, I just want to make this work in a very simple way. This really concludes the tutorial on how to do the depth first search, recursive backtracker, we know what a stack is, and all that kind of stuff, algorithm for maze generation. I will mention that if you look at this Wikipedia page, there are many other algorithms for generating mazes, and if you look through it and have some interest and implement one of these, share it with me, or write in the comments that you would really love a particular video doing a different algorithm. Try it in 3D, make your maze happen in Minecraft. I don't know, whatever you can think of, please do, and let me know how it goes for you, and I will see you in some other video in the future when I am hopefully not a robot. Goodbye. Okay, I think that worked, right, everybody? Okay, there was a question. So is he running a local web server separately while using Atom versus the built-in from the P5JS client? Yes, in fact, I am. So secretly behind the scenes, I have Terminal running. This is the web server that I'm running. I'm just using Python from a directory, python-m simple HTTP server. And that's the kind of way that I like to work. Let's just see if you have any other questions. This is it for me today. I wish people are writing some strange things in the chat that I will decide not to repeat. So I guess the last thing that I'll say is that I'll be back next week to do hopefully two sessions like this. I do need to continue those Git and GitHub tutorials. I'm really thinking about ways to make this a sustainable thing and make this more useful for people. So I might start a Slack for discussing things. I might start a Patreon. I might only open the Slack to people who contribute to the Patreon. I don't know if that's appropriate or a good idea. But let me know, do YouTube ads bother you? Is YouTube blocked where you are? What ideas do you have? Keep in touch. And you know, next fall, I'll be back and teaching at ITP, at a program at New York University. And if I can get this going and figure out how to make this sustainable, I'm going to teach the classes I'm teaching at ITP, also here like every week. That's kind of my idea. So I don't know. It's been a very long, this is the longest I've ever done a live stream. It's almost 3 hours. So I do think I need to go. I'm going to check to see if you guys have any other questions. I could make a bot that alarms you whenever I receive a tweet with the word sound in it. That's not a, a Patreon plus Slack could work. Oh yeah, people on Twitch are now catching up to the no mic. And I don't know if I don't know if I'm going to keep the Twitch thing. But anyway, we'll see. I mean, the thing is, it's all very sort of strange to me because to me, I need to write a Medium post about this. And I'm thinking a lot about education, the ways people learn and what's useful. Like, I'm enjoying doing this so much and I get positive feedback and that's great. I also find that, you know, in lecturing is kind of like not really the best way to learn and that just like trying it and doing yourself, but maybe, so in the my brain is sort of dead. So I have a lot of thoughts about this is sort of strange to me, why this works and why this what doesn't work about it. And but I'm you know this I'm in some ways I'm several years into this experiment, but I've only really been kind of dedicating myself to this a bit more strongly the last couple of weeks. So I'll remind you, sign up for my Cadenza course if you're interested. Now I'm just promoting random things. The Cadenza Nature of Code course if you're interested in more stuff like this. This is another experiment to see how does this kind of work with a kind of website that has a whole like class-based system. You can submit assignments and I'll be there in the forum answering questions and stuff like that.
send me your suggestions, send me your feedback, share my YouTube channel with people so more people discover it, especially the beginner tutorials. I like people to find those and like have this world open to them if you feel so inclined. But I'm trying to see like how much of an audience I can build here and whether there's some sustainable economic models, whether through Patreon or ads. And right now I'm just doing ads. I might add Patreon, I might remove ads, I might do it all, I'm not sure. Okay, so and the best way to get in touch with me is Twitter. So send me a tweet and I'll try to reply to everything there. Email is kind of a little bit out of control. If you have longer, more complex questions, I would ask them at forum.processing.org, and then you can tweet me a link to your forum post and I can participate in the discussion that way. But I get a little overwhelmed. I'm not saying like, oh, the whole world is emailing me, but if I get like 10 emails in a day that's like a debugging code, I can't do anything else like make these videos or work on other stuff. So audio and your challenges. Yes, I do want to do sound. Thank you for insisting. No, it's no problem that you're insisting. I know that there's so many things I haven't gotten to, and I will try to do some tutorials on audio soon enough. And just every week, feel free to remind me, and it just increases the chance that I'll get to it the next week. Okay? I'm going to go now. It's been almost 3 hours, and these videos will appear on YouTube over the next few days and next week. I kind of release them one at a time type thing. But of course, this whole live stream will be archived almost immediately. And then hopefully we'll have the time codes in it and links to other things and the code will be up. But if stuff is missing, just tweet me or put a YouTube comment in. Okay? Thanks, everybody. I'm going to hit stop now.